Symposium on toys and childhood playing with design, and I welcome not only those of you who are here physically in this room, but everyone who's joining us around the world through the miracle of the internet. Now, as Cherry can tell you, that the start of a new term is always a busy season for any academic institution. And of course, the BGC likes to make it even harder by opening not one, but two new exhibitions at more or less the same time that the faculty and the students are returning to the classroom and gearing up for a new semester. And I hope you've all had a chance or will soon have the chance to see both new exhibitions that are down the street in our gallery building. Swedish Wooden Toys, obviously in the main gallery, curated by the two conveners of today's symposium, Susan Weber and Amy Ogata, but also Zen for Film upstairs in our Focus Gallery, which was curated by our former Mellon professor in the Cultures of Conservation Initiative, Hannah Hurling. And to make things even more hectic, I believe I'm right in saying that this is the very first time that the New York Times review of our show has come out on the very day of the opening. So there's been a lot going on at Bard Graduate Center. But whatever challenges this kind of conjunction of events poses from a logistical point of view, I think it reflects in a real way BGC's commitment to pursuing its mission of studying the past through its tangible traces, what we call the cultural history of the material world, through a combined but complementary program of teaching, research, exhibition, outreach, and publication. And it's exactly that integration of those multiple educational platforms that I think makes BGC really unique among institutions of higher learning in the United States and abroad. You know, not to mention our aim of integrating faculty, students, and staff, and I have to add alums, right, Colin? Really working on the same intellectual project. And at the best moments, like today, all these factors come together in an event that brings scholars from all over to wrestle with the broader ideas and interpretive problems that are posed by our exhibition projects. And I invite you to return to this room on Monday for the symposium that will be in conjunction with our Zen for Film exhibition, and that is entitled Revisions, Object Event Performance Since the 1960s. But today, our starting point is the spectacular array of Swedish wooden toys on view down at 18, which is the brainchild of director Susan Soros and the fruit of her collaboration with her co-curator, Amy Ogata. Now, both are names that need no introduction in this room, but that is what I've been asked to do, so I will do it anyway before I turn the podium over to them. Susan Weber is the founder and director of Bard Graduate Center, where she's also the Iris Horowitz Professor in the History of Decorative Arts. She holds a PhD from the Royal College of Art and has particular expertise in 18th and 19th century British architecture, decorative arts, and design, including most recently that blockbuster exhibition and catalog of the early Georgian designer, gardener, and architect William Kent. That said, Susan has very Catholic interests, and her next project, Stay Tuned, concerns John Lockwood Kipling, a design reformer and educator who spent most of his career in British India. Amy Ogata is professor of art history at the University of Southern California, having spent many years on the faculty at Bard Graduate Center, including a stint as chair. Her research focuses on 19th and 20th century architecture, design, and material culture in both Europe and America, and that's a topic that she explored in her recent book, Designing the Creative Child, Playthings and Places in Mid-Century America, a topic with obvious relevance for today's events. Her next project concerns the visual material culture of metal in Second Empire France, which is eagerly awaited. So without any further ado, I pass the podium to one of you who's going to take it from here. Thanks a lot. Okay.
I'm going to put up the first slide.
Yeah.
Slide. Perfect. Okay. So Amy and I are really delighted to host this symposium in conjunction with our Swedish Wooden Toys exhibition, 4 years in the making. The show has been sort of infectious around the BGC, and even one of our curatorial associates in the exhibition department started his own collection of Swedish wooden toys. You can't even get into his office now. There are so many Swedish wooden toys, and we feast your eyes with some of them on the dais here. For those of you who haven't yet visited the exhibition, it brings together a wide variety of wooden toys from Sweden. The oldest is a dollhouse that you see in front of you on your left, probably executed by Burchard Precht for Princess Hedvig Sophia in the late 17th century. And the most recent object is the 2011 Cranium by Acne Jr., a line of toys made in Sweden today under the wing of the fashion and design firm Acme. Although worlds apart in time and sensibility, these two objects demonstrate the range of toys and ideas that are on view down the block at number 18. Amy.
Thank you, Susan, and thanks to Jeffrey and everybody for being here. But I'm going to continue with our little slide comparison here, and let's look at them a little more carefully. Both of these things are boxes. One is a sumptuous domestic cabinet with a locked drawer at the base, and the other is a macabre memento mori with a lobotomy. Despite the visual contrast, both are expensive items intended as much for display as amusement. And since they're made of wood, they bear the marks of their making. The cabinet is embellished with carved scrolls on the pediment in the corners, and like French fine furniture of the time, the wood is painted and gilded and mirrored, in this case, to enhance its prestige. The cranium is a smooth spherical form with a turned lid that sits on these thickly glued blocks of solid pine, and the pronounced and contrasting uses of the fibrous grain signals that wood itself is a material of value. The transformation of wood from an ordinary substance, finished only when it is painted and gilded, into a revered, even trendy, raw material indicates the continuum of the medium and the shifting values of toy manufacture in Sweden. Both toys epitomize the stylish belongings of their respective eras, and therefore they also exemplify the fact that fashionable playthings are often as much for adults as they are for children. Indeed, that line is tremendously blurred in many of the objects on view in the exhibition. And today, with the help of the scholars we have invited, we will take up that question in much more depth. In the exhibition, Susan and I were keen to explore the history of toy design and manufacture in Sweden. We have included objects that were made by hand on a rural farmstead, in elite workshops, that were patronized by the international gentry, and in various types of factory settings, from water-driven workshops of the 19th century firm Gemla, to piecework carving and standardized finishing of the Dala horse, to the modern automated conditions that typify current manufacture, much of which takes place now in Asia. We also have a rare selection of objects made by amateurs and by children themselves. Whether carved by hand with a knife, cut with a saw, turned on a lathe, or produced serially in large quantities entirely by machines, the objects in the show allow us to explore wood as a material subject. We suggest that the Swedish reverence for craft is a vital part of the story. As industrialization took hold in the 19th century, educational reformers developed a program of home handicraft, or slöjd, which stressed the perpetuation of skill. The program was as much a means of instilling discipline in children who were taught to handle tools and to follow patterns as it was the preservation of household traditions. Yet it suggests that fabricating one's own toys, like the complicated objects Bertel Hegland made for himself in the 1930s and 40s, out of scrap pieces of wood and wire, may have been encouraged by a basic level of woodworking knowledge. Swedish Wooden Toys also traces the creation of a Swedish industry. The first industrial firm, Gemla, was located in southern Sweden in a region where numerous toy manufacturers, such as the venerable firms Brio and Mickey. The elaborate sets of doll furniture, rocking horses, pool horses, cars and wagons, building sets, pistols, tabletop amusements, outdoor sets of croquet and lawn tennis, show the demand for differentiation that fueled the toy market in the late 19th and early 20th centuries. If Gemla specialized in variety, other firms adopted specific areas of production. Bailing, for example, produced these small wooden animals, and Emil Enqvist became known for a universal wooden top. Brio is probably the best known Swedish manufacturer in the US and rightly famous for their solid, brightly painted preschool toys. They were founded in the late 19th century as a kind of general store, and its wooden basket production gave way to toy making with this little wooden horse embellished with burn decoration, which became the first bestseller. Since then, Brio has become associated with high quality wooden toys, especially for preschool aged children. But Brio also produced toys for older children and for adults. Labyrinth was originally designed as a therapeutic device for wounded pilots. It eventually became one of the company's best-selling items and one of the earliest exported to the U.S. The Swedish toy industry extends beyond the manufacturers to the consumer. Department stores such as Nordiska Company influenced not only how toys were bought and sold, but also how the rest of the world saw them. NK had its logo applied to the packaging and even to objects, as you can see in both of these cases. Furthermore, NK played a significant role in the dissemination of the Swedish toy design. It mounted exhibitions of model nurseries and was also a major conduit of souvenir dollar horses. The dollar horse, a carved wooden form with a painted saddle, is typical of the Dalarna region, a place that 19th century tourism equated with pastoral Swedishness. And this is still true if this wall at IKEA, which I took in Burbank, California, right, is any indication. The dollar horse was a peasant toy, as Carl Larsson suggests in this frontispiece, showing his own children dressed in local costume playing farm. As the bright red horse gained associations of Swedish virtue and industriousness, it helped to codify a sense of Swedishness internationally. By the 1930s, the standardized dollar horse had become a popular symbol of Sweden at several world's fairs. In New York in 1939, a large dollar horse greeted visitors to the Swedish pavilion, where smaller versions were sold as souvenirs. As it lost its association with childhood and play, it gained an ambassadorial function. In many ways, wooden playthings, sentimentality, and Swedishness have coalesced in the 20th century. We have a tendency to assume that wooden toys are better, that they are of higher quality, they are more long-lasting. In the 1950s, the French critic Roland Barthes suggested that wood was a superior material in this regard. We associate wood with the tradition of rural handicraft, but it was the fuel of the Industrial Revolution in Sweden and elsewhere. Wood is not inherently innocent. It is equally capable of taking racist forms as it is of more seemingly wholesome ones. In this exhibition, we show not only a selection of marvelous wooden toys, but also how the reputation of the wooden toy has been constructed and idealized. I think we can be equally critical of our association of toys and childhood. And that's what the speakers today will explore in contexts far from Sweden, but nonetheless extremely relevant to our project. But I want to talk a little bit about how the project began. This 4 or 5 years ago when Susan came up with the idea of an exhibition on Swedish toys, and she and Nina Stritzler-Levine, BGC gallery director, began to find appropriate advisors for the project. They met Peter Plunke on that first trip, and the collection that he had formed and exhibited in his house as the Stockholm Leksaks Museum became the center of our project. But Peter's collection had now passed into the hands of the city of Rome, Italy. So this quickly became a very international undertaking. The Roma Capitale collection is particularly strong in 19th century objects and amateur-made toys. And with his deep knowledge of the Swedish toy industry, Peter helped us navigate our way through the material he had amassed. He also suggested places we should visit, and he even drove us around southern Sweden to explore the regional collections that still exist in the cradle of the Swedish toy industry. One of our first stops was this, Mickey, with the Mickey Toy Company. This is Sven Aronsson, who was one of the founders of the company and who maintains that Leksaks Museum in Gimla. In addition, we have relied on many objects from Brio, this company that is based in Osby, which maintains an extensive archive and their own museum. And this is curator Solveig Nord, who generously guided our interest and led us through the attic storerooms at the Brio headquarters. And there we are, playing in with the toys. This exhibition has been long in the making, and it's meant lots of work, but it's also a lot of good playtime. It opened in Paris last June at the Musée des Arts Décoratifs. Although smaller in scale, this show gave us an opportunity to bring many of our Swedish colleagues together and to contemplate the exuberant exhibition design by Mathalie Crassé. We want to thank all of our playmates, the lenders, the authors of the catalog, our book designer, Barbara Glauber, two research assistants, Helena Lundin and Anna-Michaela Ekstrand, and of course, the gallery staff, especially Earl Martin, whose collection is here on the table, or part of it.
a small part, and Alexis Muka. We must also thank the academic program staff, including Dean Elena Pinto-Simon and Elena Bloch, who organized today's events. Okay. So the theme of toys and childhood extends this conversation internationally in order to discover how toys, childhood, and design might be understood critically. In addition to form and materials and makers, today's speakers are concerned with how social and political considerations are part of this conversation about toys, play, and childhood. The papers parallel the exhibition in useful ways, raising questions of different national histories, of constructions of gender and race, and the new materials for the future. Our first speaker is James E. Bryan, who is Associate Professor of Art History at the University of Wisconsin-Stout. Bryan received his PhD in 2003 from the University of Wisconsin at Madison, where he was the first graduate there to earn a doctorate in art history specializing in material culture and the decorative arts. He wrote a dissertation on historic dollhouses, and his paper is entitled Material Culture in Miniature, Nuremberg Kitchens as Inspirational Toys. Can we move on to his slides? James. Yes, you're up.
Thank you. Good morning. Today I would like to discuss a particular type of doll's house, the one-room kitchen known in German as a Puppenküche. In English, this is traditionally called a Nuremberg kitchen, in reference to the city that was the hub of the toy industry when the form first appeared in the mid-18th century. Most of the oldest examples now known probably were made no earlier than the late 1700s, but the form remained fairly consistent until the mid-1800s, and so they can be difficult to date. While often quite impressive, they were intended as playthings for girls rather than as elaborate collectibles for grown women, although dolls' houses of the latter sort were certainly known at the time.
You can just use a cursor.
Oh, okay, thank you. Some of the earliest known images of these Puppenküchen, or Nuremberg kitchens, can be found in the 1803 catalog of the merchant George Hieronymus Besselmeyer. In this particular edition, Besselmeyer offered two other versions, items number 197 and number 400. Toy merchants in Besselmeyer's day were essentially middlemen, and the actual production of these kitchens, as with many German toys, was mostly done by women and children piece workers laboring in their homes, often at exploitatively low rates for long hours, with working class children ironically making toys they would never be able to play with because their families could not afford such things. Given the production methods used, with wholesalers putting in orders to numerous individual artisans, these early dolls' kitchens showed a degree of variation within a standard form. For the most part, they were single rooms with the front wall and ceiling missing, rather like a miniaturized set for the stage, to allow little girls at play convenient access to the interior and to allow admirers a better view of the miniature contents. A Nuremberg kitchen tended to have as its compositional centerpiece a raised hearth beneath a smoke hood centered on the back wall. This represented a fairly simple appliance, a masonry platform upon which a cook could tend her fires at a convenient height. Flanking this central cooking range were various shelves, racks, and cabinets for the display of pots, pans, and other implements. This furniture was arranged in asymmetrical balance, with the supporting boards often cut into decorative scalloped edges, as seen here. The collections of tiny dishes are now frequently more than the rooms can easily contain, because these kitchens were often handed down from mother to daughter, with each generation of little girls accumulating more and more miniature cookware as gifts each birthday or Christmas. Also worth noting are the numerous late 18th to early 19th century Nuremberg kitchens with chickens, ducks, guinea fowl, and so on walking about, or as in this example, pinned in a coop underneath the counter on the left. In the days before refrigeration, the easiest way to keep poultry meat fresh was to keep it alive until just before it was to be cooked. Dolls' kitchens from this period are often a dull buff or tan color, although this one doesn't display its original hue, but instead that of an older repainting. At the same time, many early examples are painted green or blue, perhaps reflecting a contemporary belief that flies avoided the color blue. Perhaps this example, and certainly this one, date to the late 18th to mid 19th century, but were repainted in the later 19th or early 20th century when white became the preferred color for well-managed kitchens. From the 18th century on, many German toys were made for export, as with this doll's kitchen intended for the French market. Its freestanding cast iron stove is but one of the new technologies beginning to enter middle-class homes in the mid-19th century. With the exception of the metal stove replacing the masonry, actually wooden, range, many mid-19th century doll's kitchens are much like their earlier counterparts. About this time, large-scale manufacturers such as Christian Hacker began to supplant the anonymous cottage industry producers of the past. As can be seen here, freestanding metal stoves could be moved about by owners so that the cooking appliance no longer necessarily formed the central element in the arrangement of the furnishings, but as we shall see, often they did occupy that position. Further, in the mid to late 1800s, in examples like this, or this, or this, dolls' kitchens that had previously been rather styleless or basic in appearance now began to display a decor that was more elaborate and Victorian, or to be precise, Wilhelmine. Along with Christian Hacker, Moritz Gottschalk was one of the most prolific manufacturers of dolls' houses at the time and produced a wide variety, but it is, of course, his kitchens that concern us most. As the 19th century ended, ordinary people became aware of the spread of diseases by microorganisms. But before the introduction of antibiotics, the best that could be done with this new knowledge was to prevent infection in the first place. Household cleanliness went from keeping things neat and pleasant to being a medical necessity. All white kitchens were promoted as sanitary because any germ-harboring filth would stand out prominently in such an environment, alerting the housewife that proper modern cleaning was in order. Floors and walls covered in shiny white tiles and furniture covered in shiny white enamel paint became the standard of modernity. However, on this scale, toy makers represented the ceramic tiles with printed papers that have yellowed over the years, somewhat altering the effect. Besides a concern for hygiene, other elements of turn-of-the-century design reform were manifested in dolls' kitchens. This one has green-painted woodwork that includes some of the whiplash curves of Art Nouveau, or in German, Jugendstil, a motif that may also be found in the blue trim of this miniature kitchen sink. The woodwork in this one perhaps owes something to Charles Rennie Mackintosh and his admirers in the Wiener Werkstätte. And this example incorporates a broad landscape-themed wallpaper frieze above a solid colored wall, a treatment often implemented by the arts and crafts movement. Dolls' kitchens continued to be made throughout the 20th century, But rather than continue on with a stylistic chronology, I would like to turn our attention to the function of these from the long 19th century. Typically, they have been described as meant to teach little girls how to be good wives and mothers when they are grown. But I would like to refine this analysis a bit. While these toys fit traditional gender roles, I would argue that they were not instructional so much as inspirational in their function, in that they did not serve to teach practical lessons in housewifery as much as to encourage young girls to see that role as something interesting and desirable, to be looked forward to and embraced. Certainly, there is a long record of Germans asserting the educational benefits of dolls' houses and related miniatures for impressionable children. One of the earliest examples is the doll's house built by the Nuremberg widow and entrepreneur Anna Kofferlin, which she opened to the public for a small admission fee in 1631. The house itself is now lost, but Kofferlin's broadsheet advertising it survives. According to the text, it was about 7 feet 4 inches tall, so that her illustrator has taken some artistic license with the scale, and fitted out with all the accoutrements of a prosperous burgher home. Kofferlin explicitly stated that she intended the doll's house to serve youngsters as an example of correct household management, writing, quote, "Therefore, you dear little children, study everything carefully, how all is well ordered, so that it will provide a good lesson. And when finally you have your own house, you will be able to organize everything in a proper way," end quote. In 1765, Paul Stetten the Younger, in his History of the City of Augsburg, commented upon the customs of the previous century, noting, quote, "Concerning the training of maidens, I must make reference to the toys many of them played with until they were brides, namely the so-called dolls' houses," end quote. Besselmeyer, the aforementioned toy merchant, began publishing his catalogs in 1793, which he entitled The Pedagogical Magazine of Instructive and Pleasing Amusements for Youth, implying that his wares were not just diverting, but more importantly, educational. As the 19th century progressed, manufacturers, educators, and intellectuals took it for granted that toys had a formative effect upon children, but disputed what their proper nature and application should be. In 1886, the trade newspaper Guide for the Toy Industry and its Related Branches stated, quote, "Nobody in our time sees a toy as simply a meaningless thing. We have recognized that toys and play have a high intrinsic educational value," end quote. In his 1904, The Toy in the Life of the Child, art historian Paul Hildebrandt specifically called for girls to learn hospitality and cooking skills by practicing with toy kitchens that were as complete and accurate as possible. On the other hand, inspired by the theories of kindergarten pioneer Friedrich Froebel, by the late 1800s, many avant-garde critics such as Ferdinand Avenarius and Joseph Augustus Lux opposed elaborately detailed toys as too specific and thus counterproductive to developing children's imaginations, and called for things that were abstract, or at least highly stylized, rather than accurate representations of real life. While their arguments did receive attention in journals serving the toy trade and in those aimed at high culture circles, they do not seem to have had much influence on the style or nature of many toy kitchens. At the same time, the abuses and hypocrisies of the very poor pay and conditions for home-based pieceworkers in the toy industry were becoming a national controversy. Public debates aside, most German commentators held that toys helped children to become good adults by encouraging cultivated mentalities and gender-appropriate expertise. However, there were probably many toy makers and parents who did not consciously think of toy kitchens as a means for shaping little girls into homemaking women, as much as they simply took it for granted that little girls would inherently prefer such gendered playthings. And surely there were little girls who did not respond to these toys as adults expected or desired. But the interpretation I wish to reconsider here is the oft-repeated notion that Nuremberg kitchens taught lessons in housekeeping. Later generations of toy historians have accepted this explanation of the instrumentality of toy kitchens without much further analysis. But after close consideration of the objects themselves, it does not appear that they were truly, directly instructional. By their nature, dolls' kitchens were not suited to convey utilitarian how-to lessons as much as they were to making managing a proper kitchen appealing through the fascinating quality artfully made miniatures can have. It is not surprising that these kitchens have been described as being more educational than a strict analysis of their usefulness as instructional models would support. As David Hamlin points out, many German toys of this era were promoted as educational, when in fact they could teach very little about the subjects they were putatively covering. Instead, merchants who wished to move product and who wished to believe that they were providing a beneficial service in doing so, and parents who wished to please their children, but who also wished to believe that they were nurturing them in doing so, engaged in a collective, tacit agreement that as long as toys made references to conventionally approved topics and behaviors, nobody would scrutinize too closely whether they actually could produce the desired student outcomes, to use the language of 21st century educational theory. For one very basic thing, a mother wishing to instruct her daughter in the practicalities of food preparation would have had no need for a miniature kitchen, but could instead easily take her child to the actual kitchen and have her observe and assist in the cooking of real meals. No doubt this occurred in countless German homes. In keeping with the notion that toy kitchens were meant to beguile more than teach is the fact that most did not actually reflect the arrangement of their full-scale counterparts, but instead reconfigured things to be more visually appealing through a symmetrical presentation of the built-in furnishings. The most obvious aspect of this is that in most dolls' kitchens, the cooking range is placed in the very middle of the rear wall. While in real German homes, it was much more likely to be tucked into a corner of the room, probably because that was more structurally stable. This arrangement was apparently long-lived, as it is seen in this illustration from the mid-17th century, as well as in this one from the mid-19th. However, there are exceptions to this pattern, as with this Nuremberg kitchen, and even more clearly, this one, that have their cooktops in a back corner rather than in the middle of the wall. For little girls actively playing with their dolls' kitchens, physical access from three sides was more engaging than that limited to just two. Many dolls' kitchens, like this one, had their side walls slanted out rather than at right angles, resulting in even greater similarity to theatrical sets and providing greater visibility for the superabundant paraphernalia, as here, and here, and here. Sometimes, as shown in this example, as well as this one, and this one, the side walls transition to the back via canted corners. This, of course, has more to do with making a little girl's toy kitchen aesthetically captivating than it does in teaching her what actual kitchen management is like, as most German homes surely had kitchens laid out as squares or rectangles rather than as trapezoids or other odd shapes. Probably the single most impressive and alluring aspect of a doll's kitchen were the various and sundry contents, made in astonishing detail in a wide array of materials, such as metals that might be elaborately embossed or lithographed, or ceramics that might be decorated with sculptural reliefs or painted colors. The checkerboard pattern Czech pottery seen here must have been very popular, as it is now found in many historic collections. While some miniaturized objects were translated into other media because the full-scale originals were made of materials difficult to handle at doll's house size, such as these imitation ceramics, many were astonishing in their accuracy, such as these copper molds lined with tin to prevent tainting the food with verdigris, just as in life-size cooking vessels. Molds such as these, for shaping jellies, aspics, and the like, are among the most prominent objects found in Nuremberg kitchens. For as true cookware, they are appropriate to the setting, but with their decorative shapes, make a more spectacular show than ordinary pots and pans. Miniaturized gadgets, such as ice cream machines, butter churns, and sausage grinders that approximated or even exactly duplicated the mechanical action of full-scale models greatly added to the interest of dolls' kitchens. For most such devices, though, this functionality was more an idea of making the thing delightful than useful. Two such examples may be seen here. On the left is a brazier to warm a pan of food over, which seems to have actually held a live fire at one time, as its wooden handle is scorched at one end closest to the metal basket. But given its small size, it likely could not keep hot long enough to cook much at all. This is even more the case with the laundry iron on the right. Both these objects are on the floor, which is hollow metal with a swinging door at its rear for inserting hot coals. In a life-size example, that would provide heat to press clothes nicely, but at this scale, the coals would probably not be able to warm their metal container to an effective temperature before they exhausted themselves. However, by the late 19th century, toy makers started producing model sheet metal stoves that did actually generate enough heat to cook very small portions of food in ways that would probably make safety-obsessed contemporary Americans cringe. These little stoves for little girls were heated by burning tea candles or lamps using various alcohol-based fuels, or sometimes by being connected to a home's gas piping, or later by electricity. While some could be ornate, others had interesting additional functions, such as the water heater on this one. Period photographs show little girls playing with, or at least posing with, these little stoves well into the 20th century. There was also an extensive do-it-yourself literature for them. Eva Stilla has discovered 10 different toy kitchen cookbooks published between 1853 and 1854, with some issued in multiple editions. These usually advised very young children to only engage in cold cooking, such as mixing ingredients but not actually heating them. For older girls, say in their early teens, the recipes could be very much like miniaturized versions of real-life cooking. While it might seem unlikely that these miniature stoves could truly function, recently enthusiasts of miniature cooking have begun posting videos on YouTube proving otherwise. Now I'll use my cursor. Let's watch as Miniature Space, whoever that might be, prepares fried shrimp on a tea candle powered stove, very much like that used by German girls over a century ago. As can be seen, it is possible to cook edible foodstuffs on these toy stoves. However, I would argue that the functionality of these devices was actually more about making them engaging rather than as useful for preparing a true meal. The most that could be made on them in a reasonable amount of time would have been a few choice morsels. But that same small scale would add to the aura of preciousness and fun associated with dolls' kitchens. Can you imagine waiting for a full serving this way? One of the ways these miniature kitchens were often used also speaks to their purpose to inspire more than to teach. In many German families, dolls' kitchens were not played with all through the year, but were only brought out at Christmas time and formed part of the decorations of the holiday season, a tradition maintained through several generations. This exact same kitchen appears in another photograph with another little girl during Christmas 1962. In summary, with their associations with the festivities of Christmas, with their functionality that was more attractive than practical, with their lavish displays of eye-catching paraphernalia, and with their layouts that were more aesthetic and theatrical than accurately representational, Nuremberg kitchens were not truly meant to provide girls with training in the skills of housewifery. Instead, they were meant to generate wonder and amusement, thereby inspiring in girls an anticipation of and desire for their traditionally expected gendered role as adults. Thank you. Yes.
We can have some questions if there are any.
Yes.
Oh, yes. Yes. Okay. So I was wondering, you talked about how the piecework was done by very, I guess, poor families. And I'm wondering, thinking about the kind of economic circumstances of people who could afford these kitchens, would these, I guess, girls and eventually women actually be doing a lot of the kitchen work, or would it not be that they would hire someone, and thus this is kind of a way to romanticize, like, labor?
That could be possible, and certainly there were aristocratic girls who would have had toys like this. Predating these objects, one of the earliest recorded dolls' houses is a kitchen made for the daughters of the Duchess of Saxony in the 16th century, and certainly they weren't going to be doing drudge work when they grew up. But I think there probably was a continuum of respectable middle-class families who wanted to keep up appearances but would actually do some household chores themselves, or would certainly need to know how to supervise the staff who were doing the household chores directly. I haven't really gotten into the economics of these objects that much. I would assume they could be fairly affordable to purchase as just the shell and then gradually acquire the contents. That was part of the fun, was always getting more little things, and too much is never enough. So I'm dancing around your question, I suppose, but to some extent, I'm sure there were girls who weren't actually going to work in a kitchen who would play with these things. Yes, in the back.
Yeah, I'm wondering if these are supposed to teach important skills to young girls, are there corresponding other domestic spaces that are used in the same way, like spinning rooms or still rooms or something? Or
is this is really, they're full-fledged dolls' houses which have every room you would want. And interestingly, in those where it's all about the house as a whole, this
the range tends to get tucked into the corner where it really ought to be. But they're full-fledged room buildings with all sorts of rooms, and then there are individualized rooms which are mostly kitchens. There are some drawing rooms and bedrooms and things like that. Another major category of those single rooms is shops. There are all kinds of shops. And then along those lines, there are also single room spaces appropriate for boys. Stables and that sort of thing. And I think it probably was the is it a doll or is it an action figure kind of debate, but by and large, the kitchens, I think, are the most popular of the single rooms. Yes?
I mean, there are these playhouses that are, you know, real life-size
yes.
Buildings that have working stoves and which are totally for elite children
yes.
who have servants galore, right?
Albert and Victoria build one exactly, for their children.
Exactly. So there is a kind of, do you think that there's a continuum here where they have the working stove and they're meant to make some eggs or something? And between
sure.
this or, and the life-size?
And you know, it could be Marie Antoinette pretending to be a shepherdess
okay.
kind of thing. So, absolutely. Absolutely. Yes?
Do they usually, I mean, my children play with miniature spaces, but it's more about the interaction between the characters, and they collect sort of multiple people. I notice there's usually one, this seems like it's more about the accessories, and there's usually one kitchen, you know, kitchen figurine.
Well, if we can get all the way back to Besselmeyer. From the beginning, these are illustrated as having miniaturized people in them, but in some ways, doll's house is something of a misnomer because you don't have to have the dolls to have the house. And in a lot of doll's houses, there aren't dolls. I've actually often found the dolls kind of intrusive because if you think about it, a miniature teapot is still a teapot. It's a really, really, really tiny teapot, but it's still a teapot. A doll is not a miniaturized person. And in fact, there are some pretty prominent miniaturized settings that deliberately avoid them. I'm thinking of the Thorn Rooms at Chicago, for instance. So the Germans seem to have had dolls with them, or the toy merchants were peddling dolls with them. But I think the children were really playing with the stuff and really imagining themselves in those spaces more than having this, you know, surrogate figurine. Yes?
Can I give some little comments?
Sure, please.
I think that when you had the miniature, the Nuremberg kitchens, you didn't really have as much the dolls as you had in the doll houses.
Yes.
And in the toy shops, and it's also a little bit later. So in the 19th century, later 19th century, you have dolls made specifically for those rooms and settings and everything else. But the Nuremberg kitchens are more instructional. And yes, you have these sort of figures, but some of those figures are not necessarily in the same form as we might have thought for a toy.
And with a lot of the museums, they actually take figurines
yes,
from
holiday
nativity sets, creches.
Exactly. And also these were taken out at holiday time under a tree, added to every year. That's another aspect.
Mm-hmm.
And maybe not seen all year.
Right. So they do become more of a display item than an interactive toy.
It's more commercial in the end of the 19th century.
Yes.
Yes. Well, the first dollhouse that we really know that some a little girl has played with is the British one, the Henshaw dollhouse from the late 17th century. And we know that she played with because she had all the dolls. And she had they were all different. I mean, some of them were homemade, clearly, and others might have been bought. And they didn't have names. And they played a role. She had Mr. and Mrs. Johnson, she had Lord Lady Mandy, she had the nurse, she had the cook, she had the several of them. So they are preserved with the names, you know, on the little note. So And the entire doll's house is one, which was a gift of the queen to her, she was the godmother, obviously she died. Her father was close to the queen, and that was Queen Anne. You find both things that are very elaborate, clearly bought and very expensive, and things that are homemade, and they are sort of mixed together. And they belong, they still are the same family, you know, these little girls' descendants, only. So you can see them in books, but they're very difficult to see in reality. So I think it's different, you know, that some girls or boys play with the dolls and they have stories, they give the action to anything. And others perhaps put themselves in it. But I think that if you put yourself in, you're probably more of a grown up.
Anne Sharp's doll's house is remarkably basic and simple for a royal gift, and it you're right, it's a child's plaything. Yes.
I was interested in questions about the purchaser of the houses, specifically probably parents.
Yes.
And to what extent? One of the things I was thinking about, and I know nothing about this, in terms of the interior of middle class German homes, late 18th, early mid 19th century. Like, to what extent, from whatever images you've been able to find of that, of those actual German homes, do these actual objects, the kitchenware, does it correspond, if you can tell? Because I'm wondering if there's a little bit of, I look at the homes and I don't think middle class or upper middle class, and I just wonder to what extent maybe, at least from the parents, not from the children's perspective, from the parents, they're kind of aspiring downward, that this is part of, this is in, you know, romantic age, and this is like the way that we still give our children, and I'm guilty myself of giving my children, guilty of, it's maybe a strange word, but giving our children, you know, home farmhouses, right? Mm-hmm. 80-90% of homes and landscapes and interiors are farmhouses we give to children, even though almost no one in the United States lives in a farm anymore, right? So there's some kind of idyllic nostalgia going on.
To answer your question, I'll confess that's not really a way I took my research, and in part to defend myself lamely. Kitchens in general aren't much noted in interior design history. Most of those sources are much more high style. And actually, I think somebody needs to write a good survey of kitchen interior design history. But I do think that it's possible that certainly we had upper class families romanticizing middle class life. But these are super abundant toys. I mean, there are tons and tons and tons of them. And the lavishness of them now could be somewhat misleading because, again, these are collections that are being accumulated generation after generation, and it wouldn't have been that expensive to buy your favorite niece a really nice little coffee grinder. You know, that might be an expensive toy, but it wouldn't be a great expense in the larger scheme of things. And toys were remarkably low priced. One of the things that was going on in the German toy industry was, you know, price wars, cost-cutting competition, and the profit margins were really lean in that industry, and they were taking it out of the workers. And to some extent, since the workers were subcontractors, they were conceivably doing it to themselves. But the items could be really gorgeous and not terribly expensive. I mean, there were some that, yes, were very high-end, very top-shelf, but there were plenty of affordable, impressive toys. I don't know how much time I have.
Yeah, about one more question.
Okay.
Okay, thanks. You mentioned at the beginning that these are known in English as Nuremberg kitchens.
Yes.
But I'm interested in kind of questioning these objects as far as their national association. So what specifically are German about these? Maybe they're produced by German-speaking communities, of course, in the 17th and 18th centuries, even in the 19th century, but before unification. So how were these different, say, than similar objects produced by their Czech neighbors or their Franco-German neighbors?
Well, that's a good question. Again, my research hasn't touched upon that. I would say that I've never seen anything about them from Slavic countries.
I agree.
And in general, as best we can tell, the doll's house is a German invention. It really first appears in southern Germany, in Nuremberg and Augsburg and Munich and places like that, in the mid-16th century. And it flourishes in Germany into the early 17th century, and then it begins to be picked up in the Netherlands. And then by the 18th century, it's picked up in England. And in some ways, it almost seems to follow the development of international capitalism. You know, the German trading centers are the centers of commerce in the late Renaissance, and then the Dutch become the big powerhouse international businessmen of the 17th century, and then the English become the big powerhouse international businessmen of the 18th century. It sort of seems to parallel that. So I would say that given that it's a German invention, it's a major product for a significant German industry, and I don't know of a lot of competition from other producers. I mean, the Germans really had a corner of the market for toys in the 1800s. Even though they're exporting them, I would say they're made from German sensibilities, and there's definitely that. I'm floundering. Thank you.
Okay, Megan Brandow-Faller is our next speaker. She is Associate Professor of History at Kingsborough College of the City University of New York. Megan received a PhD in Cultural History from Georgetown University in 2010. Her dissertation on women's art education in late Imperial and First Republic Austria won several prizes, including the Parker Schmidt Award for the best dissertation in European history. She's published articles in the Women's Art Journal, the Journal of Decorative and Propaganda Arts, and our own West 86th Street, and is at work on a book about artists, craftswomen in interwar Vienna. Her paper today is entitled Child's Play, Artistic Toys, and the Invention of Child Art in Secessionist Vienna. Megan.
And I advance like, okay. Thank you. Thank you so much for the invitation. In spring 1897, a group of young artists broke with the conservative Viennese Artists Guild to found a new league dedicated to creative freedom and originality. Framed as a generational struggle between the old and the young, scholars have long acknowledged the Vienna Secession's preoccupation with stylistic and metaphorical rebirth. But only recently have historians of art and design devoted serious attention to the idea of childhood itself as a site and metaphor for creative innovation. By examining the Vienna Secessionist invention of child art, I argue that the Klimt group's fascination with childhood and experimentations in toy making were means of reinforcing their own aesthetic rebellion and own aesthetic values. Artists associated with the progressive Klimt group first experimented with toy making around 1905, right around the time they broke with the so-called Rump Secession, which was a split largely connected to the founding of the Wiener Werkstätte, or Vienna workshops, and their valorization of the decorative or so-called minor arts. Founded in 1903, the Wiener Werkstätte was a commercial design venture attracting the Secession's leading members as collaborators. Commencing production with metalwork, the Werkstätte expanded to encompass leatherwork, bookbinding, architecture, and late in 1905, a new line of books, games, furniture, and toys intended to bring art into the nursery. Werkstätte co-founders Josef Hoffmann and Koloman Moser believed that finely crafted furniture and handmade wooden toys could not only beautify everyday life, but usher in closer contacts between artists, craftsmen, and society. Werkstätte Toys first debuted at its December 1905 exhibition at Vienna's Gallery Mietke, which marked the Klimt Group's first public appearance since breaking with the Secession earlier that year. Presenting the public with didactic examples of the Werkstätte's philosophies of functional beauty from the cradle to the grave, the Klimt Group also showcased their serious commitment to art for and by children at its landmark 1908 Kunstschau exhibition. As if to encourage visitors to recapture the aesthetic objectivity of childhood, the Kunstschau's first gallery showcased torn paper collages like these made by children. Its complement was Gallery 29, entitled Art for the Child, dedicated to female art students' innovations in children's book illustration, toy, and furniture design. On view was an artistic nursery appropriating the grammar and syntax of untutored children's drawings. This secessionist art for the child was inspired by two often contradictory premises. First, surrounding the child with beauty from an early age would lead him or her to unconsciously seek it later in life as adults. And secondly, the privileging of an alternative, supposedly childlike or primitive, way of seeing, at odds with mass market technological toys replicating the adult world in painstaking, realistic details. Secessionist toys expressed a nostalgic longing on the part of adult makers, purchasers, and critics to return to the child's naive state of artistic development. To the Klimt Group, children's art stood for the objectivity of vision, creative spontaneity, and expressive immediacy that urban civilization had buried. This fascination with the childlike was part of the broader cult of primitivism. The untutored child, thought to be uncorrupted by socialization, was believed to be a sort of domestic noble savage at a similar stage of evolutionary development as prehistoric or folk cultures. The Klimt Group's discovery of children's art was rooted in pedagogical developments. In his famous youth art classes, Vienna secessionist Franz Čižek shunned conventional methods of art instruction that privileged skill and technical accuracy. Rather, seeking to unlock the inborn creative drives he believed resided in every child, the pedagogue encouraged pupils to release inner experiences through free choice of handcraft media. A critical part of his theories was his notion that children should be sheltered from the conventions of adult art, or what he viewed as the corrupting influence of books, museums, and journals. In Čižek's classroom, children were left to teach themselves, supposedly uninfluenced by the teacher. The course's aim was patently non-vocational, to broadly nourish children's creativity and imagination without a specific professional goal, and was very popular among patrons of Klimt, the Wiener Werkstätte, and those who supported the secessionist Art for the Child movement. While secessionists like Čižek believed that exposure to sophisticated adult models shattered the child's springtime of artistic naivete, the reverse was not true for adult artists hoping to recapture a sense of the childlike. Čižek's manual on paper cutting methods for children, illustrated here on this side, not only inspired fellow pedagogues, but directly influenced contemporary art and design, particularly the childlike aesthetic of early Viennese expressionist graphic art. But Čižek and the Klimt Group's discovery of child art was far more sophisticated than straightforward visual appropriation. In the catalog to the MoMA's controversial Primitivism exhibition from 1984, curator William Rubin pointed to the ways in which primitivizing artists inflected their own values into tribal objects, arguing that the avant-garde, quote, began to collect primitive objects only because their own explorations had suddenly made such objects relevant to their own work. The discovery of African art took place when it was needed, end quote. Child art was, for the Vienna secessionists then, not an accidental discovery, but a discursive construction that reinforced their own aesthetic rebellion and secession from the secession. Chizek, for instance, openly admitted his preference for the naive, uninfluenced pupil and believed that creativity flourished in inverse proportion to the socioeconomic status of a child's family. Ironically, the very children who would have owned the toys we examine today were those he believed most in danger of losing contacts to their inner selves and roots, as he had it. For instance, Chizek found the work of his student Erich Lederer, whose parents owned the largest private collection of Klimt's works, to be derivative of the very artists that his parents collected, and he collected, Klimt and Beardsley. However, it is quite possible that the more naive, supposedly untutored works that Chizek preferred may have been influenced for the fashion of the childlike and folk art among the adult artists of the Klimt group. As problematic as the category was, the valorization of the childlike and its conflation with the primitive provided the intellectual foundations for the secessionist rediscovery of handmade peasant toys. Secessionist toy makers looked to a pre-industrial era when toys were the products of individual guild workshops. Before, as German art historian Karl Grober put it, the factory robbed the toy of the individual face that made old toys so charming. Such carved and turned wooden toys were produced by cottage industry networks in remote mountainous regions, the very exploitative industry we heard about before, and were collected by Viennese artists, including Josef Hoffmann, showing his collection here, Dagobert Pesce, and Ion Schiele, just to name a few. Josef Hoffmann assembled an impressive collection through regular trips to the Viennese flea markets and the Erzgebirge region bordering his hometown. His students recalled how their professor presented them with, quote, pictures of primitive toys as a creative stimulus to their own work. The childhood toy box of pedagogue and toy maker Emmy Zweibrück also formed the basis of a massive collection of international toys she accumulated as an adult. Recalling a crude wooden horse she purchased at a Christmas market, Zweibrück posited linkages between art making and a childlike state of creativity, suggesting that her collection provided entree to her own childhood and hence her toys' intended users. The best playthings, she argued, were, quote, made by children or people who work like children, half playing, half dreaming. Artists and peasants hit the true childlike note, end quote. In tandem with her progressive craft school for girls, which was based on the Chizek method of free expression, Zweibrück operated applied arts workshops specializing in toys, book illustrations, and embroidery that cultivated a distinctly naive folk art childlike style as a marketing strategy. The Wiener Werkstätte's commencement of toy production coincided with the end of the geometrical style of its early purist phase from about 1904 to 1906 towards an engagement with the primitivizing currents of folk and children's art exploding around 1905-1906. Enjoying particular legitimacy in designing toys and picture books for children were young female art students, supposedly equipped with a natural and intuitive understanding of the child's mind. From a picture book she created with classmate Fanny Harflinger in 1903, a stenciled image by Minka Pohajka shows turned wooden toys of the sort collected by Hoffmann and Zweibrück. Secessionist teachers like Zweibrück promoted stenciling in teaching art to children while encouraging adult designers to use the same media to produce graphic surface decoration or Flächenkunst for children. Such radically abstracted images were thought to offer children greater visual stimulation than the detailed realistic illustrations found in conventional picture books. To the artist of the Klimt group, Flächenkunst, or surface decoration, was an experimental field of two-dimensional surface decoration applicable to the flattened surfaces of painting, furniture, textiles, or graphics. It is interesting to consider that the primitivizing currents taking root in the Wiener Werkstatt to around 1906 were first transmitted from the page to the wall, that is, from two-dimensional graphic art to three-dimensional designs. Inspired in part by children's drawings, the lesson of Flächenkunst involved a radical simplification of visual reality into its most flattened stylistic essence. Yet the Flächenkunst principle could also be used in reverse to inspire three-dimensional objects of radical stylistic purity. Echoing the reductionist forms of the stencil, Harflinger and Pohajka's wooden chess set from 1906 evokes the bold colors and forms of vernacular folk toys. Its design superimposed a sense of childlike or folkish naivete onto secessionist Flächenkunst principles, particularly in the checkerboard pattern bordering the queen figure's clothing. Shown at the 1908 Kunstschau, the set was purchased by Otto and Eugenia Primavesi, who were important Klimt collectors and the Wiener Werkstatt's main financial backers after the war, for their daughter Maida, who was a devoted student of Chizek. Wiener Werkstatt toys were featured in the January 1906 issue of the journal The Child and Art, a progressive journal dedicated to awakening a love of art in children through play that was published by Alexander Kalk in Darmstadt. It is very probable that the same toys illustrated in the 26-page spread were the same ones shown at the Werkstatt's 1906 Gallery Mietke exhibition. Unfortunately, no catalog has been preserved for that show. Nonetheless, in reviews, critics noted that talented newcomers, like Pohajka and Harflinger, had been recruited for the Werkstatt's new line of artistic toys. The article accompanying the images was written in a playful journalistic style targeted to the journal's adult subscribers. Through its patently childlike visual description, the text implied that readers might transcend adult ways of seeing and relive childhood memories by purchasing such playthings for their offspring. Turned wooden toys designed by Pohajka and Harflinger seem to invite the journal's readers to, quote, play with them right now, even though they are just in the picture and not real, end quote. With their stiff, bowling pin-like shapes, Harflinger's trademark Viennese types, like these Rococo figurines here, drew on the stylized anonymity typical of the vernacular toys that adult consumers valued as supposedly more timeless, less commercial than mass-produced toys. The likelihood that Harflinger's figurines served as a source of amusement to adults and potentially awakening the magical land of childhood that artists like Zweibrück valued is suggested by a 1920 photograph from the studio of Viennese portrait photographer Madame d'Ora. In the photo, Harflinger's figurines have been posed in a theatrical setting evocative of Velázquez's Las Meninas. The animated quality that reviewers found present in the figures is apparent in the elaborately staged image, in which a crinolined infanta figure, flanked by a retinue of courtiers and dwarfs, proceeds into a stately hall. So strong are the connotations to the Spanish Habsburg Golden Age immortalized by Velázquez that it is easy to forget that this mise-en-scene is one of miniature playthings, particularly in the ways in which both artists play with various levels of reality, image, and reflection. The toys of Minka Pohajka, Harflinger's classmate and colleague, were regularly featured in art and design journals as well, illustrating the designer's trademark interpretations of exotic animals and fantasy creatures. Pohajka used the turning lathe, a traditional method, to produce highly original, idiosyncratic, and delicate forms that often reference their manner of construction in a humorous fashion. Despite the ways in which toy making was viewed as essentially and especially suited to women, male artists of the Klimt group, like Pesha and Cheska, also experimented with toy making. Wiener Werkstatt co-founder Koloman Moser was especially active in toy making, designing special hand-painted wooden sets, building sets like this one here, for his own children, for his own son, Carl. Moser is known to have designed toy building sets, like these versions of the town, wooden grotesque figures that were painted by his female students, and a variety of secessionist Easter eggs, like this secessionist egg here, which exploits the dialogue between positive and negative space. Likewise, inspired by Chizek's revival of paper cutting, a media that was not only critically linked to children, but also female amateurs, Moser published a series of colored paper collages in the special issue of The Child in Art that I mentioned before. It also contained detailed instructions for both parents and children to make similar collages at home through very simple techniques of symmetrical folding and multi-layered cutting. Chizek's manual on paper cutting for children prized vernacular traditions of paper cutting, like silhouettes, as models of simplicity, authenticity, and adherence to the laws of the material. To ensure that work corresponded to a spontaneous inner necessity, children were instructed to cut their designs directly into the paper, forego any preliminary drawing. Alternatively, like we see here and in the slide I showed you before, paper could also be torn to produce a more agitated contour. Kolo Moser's colleague Hoffmann also designed a wide variety of artistic objects for children, wooden playsets, and also the silver Easter egg we see here, inlaid with semi-precious stones. But once again, Viennese critics wondered whether such toys did not suit the artistic proclivities of adults rather than children. Surely children, one critic reasoned, would have been more interested in the sweets housed inside the egg rather than the elaborate decorative shell. Design spaces for children featured in Hoffmann's most important architectural commissions, such as the Palais Stockley in Brussels. Hoffmann's design for the larger children's room, overlooking the garden, featured a central area for play and study with a sturdy wooden table and chairs with posts in the form of bird's ears, and a decorative frieze of safari animals by young art student Heinrich Jungnickel. Executed in a childlike visual style, the frieze is striking in the juxtaposition of white and green figures against the expressive jagged forms of the black ground. Jungnickel's Stockley frieze inspired the design of a textile called High Forest that was used in another major Wiener Werkstatt commission, the Primavesi country estate in Moravia, a residence whose owners were definitely dedicated to the secessionist cult of childhood as much as they were folk art. They were also the same individuals who purchased the chess set I mentioned before. However, if Hoffmann and Moser's design work for children remains relatively unknown, it is because toys and design spaces for children have been marginalized in mainstream histories of design, often viewed as a distraction from more serious pursuits. While Moser's playsets and Easter eggs were presumably designed for the nursery, other Werkstätte products were intended as playthings for adults alone. An apt example of the adult nostalgia for an idealized landscape of child's play and the raw, childlike aesthetic of early Viennese expressionism is found in the so-called secessionist tarot set, card set, that Moser's wife Edith created for the Werkstätte. Much like the elaborate secessionist dollhouse designed by her older sister, Magna Mautner von Markov, Edith Moser filtered secessionist Fleischenkunst through a deliberately childlike eye. Produced in limited editions for the Moser's friends as gifts, the cards were dotted with vernacular toys and human figures whose formal qualities echoed the stiff rigidity of the vernacular toys secessionists remembered and collected. Critic Ludwig Vesey was so taken by the set's, quote, primitive little vignettes, pieced together of naive primary colors in a mosaic-like fashion, that he proceeded to immediately play with his set. The cards were profuse with images of the artist's own childhood. For instance, the garden facade of the country estate where she was born, the rolling beer kegs of the Mautner-Markov family brewery, the giant Ferris wheel of Vienna's public park. And here we see the wall clock in the background of the three card, cleverly referencing the fact that it was the 3 o'clock, 3 card. This is a 3 o'clock Jause, or afternoon coffee scene. However, much like her sister's elaborate secessionist dollhouse, so perfect and complete in every detail that critics jested that, quote, any modernist doll would be ready to move in immediately, Moser's secessionist Tara card set ultimately seemed more appropriate for aesthetic contemplation and display than for ease of use. And they are really hard to read. I've held them. He's right. One of the most profound collisions between toys and the secessionist preoccupation with childhood is found in Gustav Klimt's 1912 portrait of Maida Primavesi, the strong-willed daughter of Werkstätte patrons Otto and Eugenia, who commissioned the residence we saw before. The Primavesis were devoted to the progressive cult of the child and showered their 4 children with artistic toys like the chess set we saw before that they purchased for Maida. Like other Klimt Group patrons, Maida was a Chizik student, drawn back to his classroom well beyond the age when he believed that adolescence stymied free expression. Paintings like her peasant wedding were included with the exhibition that toured the United States in the 1920s. But it is well worth questioning if the adolescent Maida truly grew from her own roots, as Chizik has it, had it, or whether she was under the spell of the same primitivizing currents favored by the Klimt group and used at her parents' estate. Klimt himself was a great enthusiast of child art, finding it to possess the same raw elemental power as the art of tribal peoples. It is interesting to consider the ornamental backdrops of work from Klimt's later period, like this portrait, as a sort of formal play. Indeed, for Klimt and the younger generation of Viennese expressionist he mentored, childhood was a potent crucible for an ability to wander, to dream, to be spontaneous, to destroy, and to create. Like the crystalline fragments of a toy kaleidoscope that could be shaken and rearranged indefinitely, surface ornamentation provided Klimt's decorative fantasies with inexhaustible creative possibilities in his path towards a two-dimensional form of surface covering that combined the planarity of painting with the materiality of mosaics, another form of applied art. What is striking about the portrait is the contrast between the unusual precocity of the child's subject and the playful ornamentalism of the childlike dreamscape surrounding her. Maida straddles a triangular white carpet populated with childish playthings. These toys strongly recall Pohajka's stylized animals, which Klimt undoubtedly remembered from the 1908 Kunstschau exhibition, where her toys were featured in the Art for the Child section. According to interviews with the sitter, Maida, the playthings were the products of the artist's imagination. No real toys were used as models, and it was Klimt, not the child, who decided to include them in the portrait. Klimt's depiction of Maida separates her from the material world of childhood surrounding her, making the painting neither an adult nor child portrait. At Klimt's instigation, Maida was portrayed in an iridescent white lawn dress, accentuated with wired flowers and beads, commissioned from his lifelong companion, the reform clothing dressmaker Amelia Floge. The viewer is immediately struck by the child's self-assured precocity, her gaze unswervingly meeting the viewer's as she assumes a characteristic pose, shoving her left arm behind her back with her left elbow jutting out. But her dress, pose, expression, and position at the very edge of the picture plane signal Maida's psychological distancing from the adult fantasy of childhood opening up behind her. Klimt's painting brings together key themes in the invention of child art in secessionist Vienna. Childhood held powerful and multivalent meanings in secessionist Vienna, meanings that informed the design of handcrafted artistic toys. The Vienna secessionists believed that children were blessed with uncorrupted aesthetic vision, a characteristic they apparently shared with the vernacular culture of supposedly primitive peoples. Both offered sources for unlearning the stale conventions of academic art in service of the secessionist artistic rebellion. Toys were significant within this cultural milieu because, as the key artifacts of childhood and a traditional product of peasant production, they existed at the nexus of these concerns. Traditional wooden toys offered examples of the vernacular aesthetics so valued by the artist of the Klimt group, while awakening memories of their own childhood playthings. Such toys provided the inspiration for new products, appealing to the taste of cultivated adult Viennese consumers, designed by artists of the Wiener Werkstätte. It was natural, then, that such wooden toys should form the backdrop that Klimt imagined for Maida Primavesi. His painting, then, suggests that secessionist toys and the broader preoccupation with the childlike may have meant as much to adults as to children.
It was believed that women were better at making toys than men. So I have two questions stemming from that. You know, who believed that? And then the second question being whether, you know, this was evinced in sort of commentary or, you know, consumption by critics and then consumers, you know, both, I guess, both children and adults. And I guess, you know, there was also a difference in how children and adult consumers of the toys, you know, sort of perceived this male-female dichotomy.
So the second part of the question was asking how the consumers of the toys perceived the gendered nature of toy making?
Yes, yeah. If they saw, you know, one, if females were indeed superior.
Okay. So definitely, so first of all, you may have heard, you know, when to the extent that toys were reviewed by critics, they the critics tended to assume a naive, often playful voice. And you see these essentialist links between women and children particularly strong in the writings of Amelia Levetis, who was the resident Viennese critic for the studio. And she repeatedly makes this claim that it was women who were equipped with a psychological understanding of the child's mind, which is very interesting. It's very interesting when you have figures like, you know, Anna Freud and Charlotte Bühler writing about child sexuality at the same time. And she almost, at some times, you know, is not to say disappointed, but implies that it was, you know, really these male Coleman Moser, Hoffman is making toys too. So you really do see that this was, you know, okay, they should get back to furniture here. As to how the gendered nature of the toy making was perceived by the consumers, I frankly don't have any I don't have any information on that. I don't have any sources that that address that. So
I'm curious about some of the toys that you showed. It reminded me a lot of slightly later toys made by Dada artists, like Zurich Dada, like Emmy Hennings and Sophie Teuber. And I'm wondering if there are connections there, or just it happens to be that those forms kind of come up in modernist visions of toy making. What have you thought about that at all?
If there were, I would presume that the Dada artist, you know, there's a great recent book on that, may have likely been, you know, familiar with these modernist versions of vernacular toys. I would be highly surprised if they weren't. You know, what is going on in Vienna was not specific to Vienna. There was, you know, most of the Central European arts and crafts workshops are doing similar toys. You know, the Dresden workshops were the first to do it. So I am sure that they were familiar with it. And like I suggested, how these modernist interpretations of the vernacular toys look certainly related to the aesthetic values of the makers. As for very, very specific connections, that's hard to say.
Sure.
Thank you.
I'm curious about the relationship between Chizik and the secessionists and Friedrich Froebel, since they were both concerned with childhood and objects, even though Froebel didn't consider his work toys.
Yeah, so Chizik is very well known. You know, in the history of children's drawing and the reform of children's drawing, what has been understudied is very specifically his connection to design. And specifically, well, let me go back to the first part of the question about purple. So Chizek definitely was in the tradition of these German liberal reformist thinkers who are favoring more creative ways of teaching children. He differed, however, from the likes of Pestalozzi in that generally Chizek regarded the 19th century attitudes towards teaching children art as too regimented. So, you know, although he is in a tradition, you know, with Rousseau, Pestalozzi, Froebel, he rejected, for instance, Pestalozzi's methods as too regimented, too rigid, too much of copying line, that he does away with altogether. So Froebel is important. The broad idea of the object lesson and self-activity and creative play, but Froebel's methods specifically, the gifts and the occupations were too rigid, too structured. An interesting parallel between Froebel and Chizek is Chizek has a certain spirituality to the way he perceives child art, which is very, very strong. And it's not something that's difficult to express, but all of the visitors to his classroom just conveyed the sense that this was a mecca of child's art, that this was this Sistine Chapel of child art. So you see often like these religious parallels. There was this certain spirituality to it, and that would be an obvious parallel to Froebel. So the brief answer, it is in the general line of tradition, but a rejection of the specific prescriptive methods of the 19th century, and really a focus on the child's free expression. Now, Chizek is a matter of debate in the literature because he was famous for allowing children to draw from their imagination, supposedly non-prescriptive, but he did have methods. He did have certain rules. Maybe that's overstated, but certain guidelines for children.
I was going to ask you, the interesting thing is the irony is in some of the commercial manufacture, you see some of the same themes echoed that they see. Maybe they were, I believe they were influenced by what was going on. In, for instance, wallpaper trims, some pictures that were made in Germany for children's dolls houses and things like that. So I see some of that in there, in some of the idealism that was shown. And I wanted to ask you if you'd comment about the fact of the interesting aspect historically that you have World War I sort of come in between some of this, and how you, and perhaps the protection of the child, or the thought of the child, or the child and the mother. Is there some theme in there that you want to
think about the
fact that it the time frame goes from a period of time that goes right into it transcends both periods of time from before World War I to after World War I in terms of the dating that you've shown.
Okay, so you're asking more about the maternalist movement?
Just any thoughts that you have about the effects or in relation to World War I.
Okay, World War I. So the one, I chose to do something different with my other publications, so that I've done so far. Vienna's toys, Secessionist toys, Wiener Werkzeug toys are certainly not ahistorical and, you know, timeless and unchanging. I could have done a historical survey of toy making and Wiener Werkzeug's toy making into the interwar period, because they're doing aesthetically very different things that are relating to some of the experiments they're doing in the interwar period, which related to Chizek's ideas on kineticism. He was basically, I was almost going to bring up this in the other question, but Chizek was really doing things parallel to Johannes Itten at the Bauhaus, and was encouraging and applying his theories to adult designers and encouraging them to express inner experiences, emotions, abstract sensations through ornament, actually, and color contrast. So the answer to your question is you do see some of this experimental work applied to toys, which are doing a lot with color contrast and even more abstract than stylized than the ones we see here. as for the influences of the maternalist discourses on toys, that's not something I've researched and I would have to think more about, but that's a very interesting thing to bring up.
Did Chizik's ideas influence how children's books were illustrated at the time?
Sure.
Are there a lot of examples of that?
Oh, right, yes, absolutely. You know, these ideas were being a part of a broader so-called Kunsterziehung Bewegung, so art education, but in the sense of upraising movement. So, you know, I don't want to overinflate his importance. He's certainly very important, but there were others coming to the very same ideas at the same time. And another like seminal figure would be Alfred Lischbach, working in Hamburg, who does a lot with teaching children in a more creative way. He thinks that the German youth are totally focused on sort of root learning, memorization, and any aesthetic sensibility they have is drilled out of them. But specifically, he's very concerned with more creative, less realistic types of book illustration, and organizes a series of conferences. Yes.
Have you thought about the sort of cross-fertilization going on in Great Britain at this time, at an earlier period with people, children's book illustrators like Walter Crane, and because to me there's a tremendous sort of affinity between some of those illustrations and Crane's earlier illustrations.
Yeah, this is something that I'd like to actually do more on. I'd like to really get into the graphic art and the graphic work. And so the answer is yes, and I would like to tease out the more specific ways that these ideas came.
And where are these actual toys preserved that you show?
Almost the actual ones I show today were all from a private collection. You know, for the most part, they're not the centerpieces of the big applied arts museums. There are some in Prague, and you know, they're sort of.
There's some in Nuremberg too.
Yeah. So, you know, they're in the applied arts museums. A lot of private collections. This one is in the museum in Baden. Mm-hmm. Some of the most important ones are, you know, just in the chess set is in a Viennese gallery at the moment. It's for sale, I believe. So, you know, they're sort of floating around. They're not necessarily all centralized.
And the family that they were made for, what happened to that family?
The Primavesi?
Yeah.
Oh, sure. I mean, I could say quite a lot. So the Primavesis. Maybe we'll just go to Maida here. So the Primavesis first met Gustav. So I should probably say her mother was a major proponent of these reformist theories towards children. They had four children. She was trained as an actress, but sort of transferred her creative energies to raising her children in an artistic way. And she becomes the financial backer of the Wiener Werkstätte, she and her husband, after 1914. But it's really Eugenia, the mother, who is the leading force and the instigation in this. And it actually drives apart the marriage. They go bust in the 20s, go bankrupt. Eugenia, however, becomes artistic director of the Wiener Werkstätte, is very close with Hoffmann, and supports the women in the Wiener Werkstätte in the interwar period against efforts to rationalize the Wiener Werkstätte and make it more practical and introduce serial production. So she was this staunch advocate of this, you know, handcraft against the reformist ideas.
And what happens to Mala? Do you know?
Oh yeah, she lived. She immigrated to Canada. The house burnt down. I didn't actually show the picture of the estate, but it burnt down in 1923. She came to Canada later in life and lived a very long life, dying in her 90s, and the painting was purchased for the Met, so it's nearby.
The house's interiors are well documented. It exists, it burned down, but the rest of the home, is there really good
This here? So this, I mean, if you're really quite interested, I can give you the source to look it up. There's an extensive spread in Deutsche Kunst und Dekoration from 19, it's shown right here, from 1916, I believe. I can give it to you later. But you can see there's really strong connections, I think, between the parents' interest in art for and by children and the mother's interest in folk art. She, major collector in this sort of modernist versions of folk art.
And Hoffmann was also, I mean, as you suggest, very interested in folk art. And had grown up in this kind of Moravia, or maybe.
Yeah, absolutely.
But anyway, on margins, kind of.
Right. Right. So this.
Could you go back to the portrait of Madden?
Sure, of course.
How old is she in that picture?
She is 10.
She is 10.
This was commissioned for her 10th birthday. She was supposedly the father's favorite child and the only child. She's the only child to receive a, you know, a Klimt child.
And the art class.
Well, she looks older than 10. In it. And the point you're making is, I think she's leaving childhood behind, and she's very, she has agency. Assuming that fashions in Austria were very similar to those in England, her hairstyle would have immediately signaled to anyone she's still a child, even though she looks very adult, because girls didn't put their hair up until they became considered women. So. It's just striking.
Yeah, no, I think that you're nailing what I'm trying to get at, and that she's in this liminal space, adult, childlike, you know, making her art making being very, very folk-like. I think that's an excellent point to raise. She, of course, hated the parents' house. She hated No, I'm sorry, I don't have a slide of her room, but. She had a similar room. This was the central playroom, and the children's rooms were connected to this. And the story is she supposedly hated a room, the Hoffmann textile, and went to play in the one of the outbuildings, the unfinished woodshed, to escape this Gesamtkunstwerk.
Did she have the blue chevron wallpaper?
Yes, exactly.
And she said it drove her mad, and she would sleep outside.
Yes, that's it.
It dazzled her eyes too much.
That's it, exactly.
Well, is this sort of a motif in, I mean, not just at this moment, but in any situation in which parents are consciously choosing kind of an alternative form of, I mean, let's say toys as pedagogy in some way,
right?
That children don't necessarily, I mean, I liked very much your point in reading the painting about not just distancing from childhood, but distancing from an adult's vision of what childhood should be. I mean, I think that's quite fascinating.
And yeah.
So this idea of reacting kind of against the pedagogical model that your parents are imposing through play, it seems like that could be traced in a number of different chronological directions. I mean, it's probably, I mean, I feel like this, you know, Amy was mentioning in the beginning this idea that we have this sense of wooden toys as being somehow noble, or you know, and you certainly find this today, right? I know many mothers who say, oh, my children have only wooden toys, and you know, and their kids, meanwhile, are trying to find the plastic, like, you know, Hello Kitty or whatever it is. I mean, I'm just wondering if that's come into your thought about just this relationship between childhood and visions of childhood. Mm-hmm.
I think that is obviously something that's not specific to Vienna.
Yeah.
You know, very rarely. I mean, only in the post-war period do you have toy makers marketing directly to children, which of course Gary Cross has written about, and it's revolutionized the whole ball game because, you know, now you can cut out the adults and go directly to the children, which makes things very interesting. But as I can, I mean, any of the toy scholars here could tell you, toy reformers, pedagogues at the time write about the notion of the invented toy, how fantastic, simple things, pieces like blocks of wood are, and how these offer much more possibilities for imagination of the child. And, you know, to answer your question of how children reacted against these adult ideas is how children tended to destroy, you know, their toys. That the toy reformers write about this again and again and again, how children, when given toys that are so perfect, so, you know, replicating the world, the adult world in exact detail, the only way that they can express themselves or have something of their own is to destroy it, or in the case of Neda, to seek refuge from the blue and white stylized chevron in the alphabet. So, yeah.
Do you see yourself as a toy scholar, or an art historian?
I consider myself an interdisciplinary scholar, doing cultural history, material culture, art history. Thank you very much.
Okay, Colin Fanning is our next speaker. Colin is currently a research fellow in European sculpture and decorative arts at the Philadelphia Museum of Art, where he helped to organize an exhibition on Scandinavian design, which is on view at the PMA until October 4th.
So get there soon,
right? Fanning received an MA at the Bard Graduate Center in 2013 and is the co-author with BGC alum Rebecca Meir of an article on play, technology, and Minecraft. And Minecraft is something Swedish, actually. Notch is Swedish. Colin's paper is Building Kids, Design, Creativity, and Lego.
Thanks so much, Amy. It is always such a treat to come back to the BGC, although I have to admit, slightly surreal to be on this side of the podium. But we'll see how this goes. One of the most popular toys of the past century, Lego bricks have long been associated with a triumphant narrative of invention and creativity. As scholars who study the material culture of childhood have shown, particularly Amy with Designing the Creative Child, the purportedly inherent connection between children and creativity was in part constructed by post-war toy manufacturers, educators, psychologists, and parents who sought to direct children's play towards productive ends. Building toys like Lego, with their associations of both instructive rationality and free-form expression, provide a particularly interesting site of inquiry for teasing out how these adult aspirations have been reflected in design for children. Lego's early products built on tropes well established by earlier playthings, but as the Danish company grew from a purveyor of mostly traditional wooden toys into a sophisticated global corporation over the second half of the 20th century, it was continually forced to adapt to new market conditions and new ideas about play. By materializing and commodifying the notions of individuality and originality, Lego tethered the abstract quality of creativity to the concrete act of playful building. And unlike some of the associations with educational wooden toys and that emphasis on handicraft, it's significant that these are mass-produced objects. So my aim today is to explore how Lego has given physical and visual form to this ideal through the design of its products and marketing ephemera, as well as how its approach has changed over the decades, at times leaving the toys sitting uneasily against their stated ideals. Additionally, I'm interested in examining how the toy has penetrated cultural spaces outside the children's playroom. Ultimately, I hope to add a little nuance to the pioneer discourse that characterizes the received view of Lego's history, showing that this aura of creativity surrounding the icon of modern childhood was not intrinsic, but rather shaped in response to larger cultural and economic shifts over the 20th and 21st centuries. The massive multinational corporation we know today as Lego had rather humbler beginnings in the rural community of Billund, Denmark. Ola Kirk Christensen, the company's founder, started a carpentry shop there in 1916, building things like millwork for houses and simple furniture. And during the Depression, he focused more on household goods, ironing boards, stepladders, that sort of thing. And then as a byproduct of these, began making wooden toys from the small offcuts. During the Depression, he focused on producing, by 1934, Christensen had decided to shift his business entirely to toy production, renaming the company Lego, a contraction of the Danish phrase for play well. The toys from this period drew upon conventional forms like pull-along animals and vehicles, and their apparently high-quality construction and durability earned Christensen and his company a good reputation. But one curiosity that remains unexplained in the official company histories that I've only just in the past month or so become aware of is the presence of several Lego products from as late as the 1950s, in fact, that mirror almost exactly those sold by the Swedish company Brio, best known today for its wooden trains. And you can see here a comparison of a Brio poster and a Lego catalog, and a Brio toy and a Lego toy. As Solveig points out in a catalog essay for the BGC's Swedish Wooden Toys exhibition, Brio was an active wholesaler and exporter of toys, and at times purchased toys from independent manufacturers to resell. So whether Lego is importing directly from Brio or buying from the Brio's suppliers directly or simply copying Brio's design is something that's an opportunity for further research, although I imagine neither company is particularly interested in seeing that come to light. Whatever the case, it's evident that Lego's early years fit very neatly within this sort of paradigm of the Scandinavian wooden toy maker, paralleling the history of many of the manufacturers whose products you can see down the street in 18. Its genesis as a carpentry shop, the kinds of toys it sold, even down to the periodic factory fires and subsequent rebuilding, all tie the company to the long tradition of wooden toys in Scandinavia. So really relying more on precedent than any particular culture of innovation. Even Lego's first plastic bricks, introduced in 1949, had their genesis in an act of imitation. When Christensen had purchased a plastic molding machine from a British machine tool company during his post-war rebuilding in 1946, he received some manufacturer's samples of a product sold by the British company Kiddycraft. These self-locking bricks had been designed by the company's founder, the designer and child psychologist Hilary Page, who studied and wrote about the role of play and playthings in children's development. And after slightly altering the design, which you can see Page's version here and Christensen's there, he began producing his own sets of bricks in Billund. Page's design had its own precedent in earlier architectural building toys with similar attachment mechanisms, like the pressed paper Belgian Batema from 1905 or the rubber British mini bricks from 1935. As the architectural historian Alice Friedman has written, the toys of this nature were intended, quote, not simply to teach dexterity or design skills through play, but to mold the behavior, aspirations, and desires of future citizens and consumers, end quote. Page echoed this long-running belief in the specific benefits of construction play in his 1953 book, Playtime in the First 5 Years. But he also argues that though the physical and mental occupation of the child is the chief concern of a plaything, imagination and the child's interiority are also important. He writes, quote, preparation for the adult world is daily enhanced as the child learns many of its laws and lessons through the process of imaginative play. No less important, however, is the embracing refuge offered by Playland from the frustration and distresses of reality, end quote. Nevertheless, Page's bricks and Lego's copies were, in their strong connections to this long tradition of architectural toys, initially more focused on providing a vehicle for children to learn coordination and principles of rational building. And Lego's design treatment of the bricks in this era fit very closely with what Birgitta Almqvist has noted as the hallmark of 20th century educational toys, quote, plain in structure, texture, form, and color, and gender neutral to suit girls as well as boys, end quote. Though they drew on these well-established toy conventions, Lego's plastic bricks were far from an immediate commercial success. While plastic toys accounted for almost half of the company's revenue by 1953, the automatic binding bricks made up at most only 7% of sales, which is pretty hard to imagine now. Christensen's son Gottfried began to rethink the company's product lines in 1955, after reportedly hearing a purchasing agent at a trade fair complain that there was no system behind toy manufacturing. He lit on these already modular bricks as a good candidate for such a system and set about crafting a new conceptual framework, a sort of master narrative that would guide both the selling and ostensibly the use of the toys. This was the beginning of the Lego System I Like, the system of play, which repositioned the existing individual sets within a cohesive town plan conceit. And the generically modern sets from this era and the logic of the system especially resonate with the prevalence of functionalism in post-war Danish architecture and urban planning. And amid a really active period in Europe for new ideas in school and playground and urban design, there was a broad consensus among educators and child psychologists and ambitious middle-class parents that wholesome playthings were really key to fostering a child's skills and personality. The result was a widespread preoccupation in post-war Europe with the so-called good toy, tied closely to this discourse of regeneration that crystallized around things designed for children. Reinforcing the idea of a vulnerable child in need of parental guidance and protection, good toys were positioned in opposition to what many also saw as the needless realism, over-emphatic novelty, or chaotic and violent potential of cheaper mass-market toys. And while the notion of the good or real toy typically described objects made in wood, thereby emphasizing tradition and high-quality manufacture, Lego consciously marketed the plastic bricks as part of the same discourse. So these advertisements read in translation, quote, "It is a pleasure to see children playing with Lego. Lego play is quiet and stimulating. Children learn to grapple with major tasks and solve them together," end quote. It's noteworthy, too, that the images of ideal play offered by Lego in this period were often collaborative. You see these children playing together. In a wider social sense, these designs reflected a sort of patriarchal image of the happy family that the sociologists Hanne Warming and Jan Kampmann have seen as a true cornerstone of childhood in mid-century Denmark. In 1958, Lego patented a redesigned brick, which sported tubes in the hollow underneath that clicked between the studs atop other pieces, and you can see the patent here. This gave the toys what the company today calls clutch power, where the components stick firmly together while remaining easy to separate again. This small alteration to the design of the bricks is continually cited by both the company and critics as the key factor that allowed for the rapid expansion of component types within the Lego system. However, the company's growing success was tied to geography as much as it was to design. The company had been expanding gradually into new markets, first within Europe with a major 1956 breakthrough into Germany, then to North America in the early 1960s through a licensing arrangement with Samsonite, debuting at the 1962 New York Toy Fair, with this sort of scaled-up version of the town plan. Until its licensing agreement ended in 1972 and Lego itself took over the North American distribution, Samsonite sets tended to emphasize the more elemental nature of block play and the wider representational potential of these abstract bricks. And this placed the bricks sort of on a similar footing with many of the other creative playthings being sold to a discerning middle-class audience in the US around the same time, and many of those were also imported from Europe. But perhaps the most explicit link between Lego and the wider post-war discourse on these good toys was a company policy Christensen instituted in 1962, 10 principles of play intended to be a guiding philosophy for the company. And while these principles, you can see they sort of foreground the child's play experience, couched in a sort of optimistic, universalizing language, they also get at the underlying rationale for the brick system-based marketing, making this tidy linkage between the play value of the toy and the amount a consumer might buy. It's convenient. As the company expanded into new markets, and as the product line began to grow more and more diverse, Lego slowly moved away from the strict emphasis on didactic value in its design and marketing. And while that vein of rhetoric certainly remained, this construct of creativity as a tangible benefit, something that's readily available for purchase, really rose to the fore in Lego marketing. Variously inflected by notions of children's mastery, individual expression, and narrative play, the Lego system took on a new, colorful expansiveness in the last quarter of the 20th century. One of the major changes in the Lego product line to reflect this was the company's introduction of the play themes in 1978. Conceived as a sort of system within a system, the play themes were the idea of Gottfried Kirk Christensen's son, Keld, the grandson of Ola, who had grown up deeply connected to the bricks, and in fact was one of the children models on many of the early packaging. So it runs deep in this family. These new theme sets had step-by-step building instructions and were drawn from genres familiar to children's literature and toys, starting with this castle, and other themes like pirates and science fiction and westerns and so on soon followed. Simultaneously, the company introduced these minifigures, which established a sort of standard scale for Lego buildings and provided children with miniature avatars for their play. And we're sort of encountering the absurdism of PowerPoint because this is a massive minifigure, but remember, they're about an inch and a half tall. Some scholars have seen Lego's adoption of broader subject matter in the theme era as an important shift in emphasis from construction play to narrative play, where the bricks become mobile objects like race cars and spaceships rather than static constructions. But by combining the challenge of construction toy and new possibilities for kids' role play, Lego hoped to retain its associations with tradition while remaining relevant in a changing market, suspicious that the educative aspirations of the good toy might be growing old-fashioned in the minds of consumers. I think we can also see these fantasy settings as an attempt to respond directly to growing competition from, in particular, the themed playsets of the German Playmobil toys, which were sold internationally from 1975, and the influence of merchandise associated with children's television programs, both of which contributed to the powerful presence of genre-inspired, narrative-driven toys in consumer homes. This shift played out materially as well in the design of Lego sets and graphic ephemera, like packaging and catalogs. Rather than offering wholesome imagery of children engaged in quiet play, company designers now presented the toys themselves as the actors and agents of playtime, with buildings, vehicles, and minifigures arranged in these tableaus depicting these sort of frozen moments of action. And this new sort of visual richness constructed a sort of cohesive Lego universe that was populated by the company's products. And this major turn in the visual culture surrounding the system is an example of what historian Gary Cross has seen as a savvy move by manufacturers to focus more on children's desires rather than on prescriptive parental ideas about play. This is echoed by the company itself in the words of Olaf Dahm, a Lego employee in the 70s and 80s who appointed himself the company's philosopher. He argued that, quote, "Play is for the most part undisciplined, free, voluntary, and it is fun. We can tend to take toys so seriously that we forget they must be fun. Children's play and grown-ups' work are very different," end quote. And media scholar Stephen Klein has also argued that Lego's stratification of its product line, differentiating along subject matter as well as age, with the 1979 Duplo line aimed at toddlers or the 1977 engineering-focused Technic series for older builders, provided a means of staying within this sort of comfortable space of construction toy conventions while capturing a much wider audience and achieving a sort of brand loyalty among children from a very young age that they can then work their way up as they get older. But it seems that Lego largely managed to escape the adult anxiety that often accompanied this sort of corporate targeting of young consumers by continuing to push the purported benefits of playful building. Dahm also asserted that, quote, "It is important that the materials children get in their hands is not finished, not ready-made," end quote. Lego visually reinforced this message by showing alternative building ideas on the backs of set boxes. And this is one of those small details of design that I think often gets forgotten in the sort of retroactive criticisms of these themed era sets as being overly prescriptive with their instructions. And in some advertisements, Lego backed off entirely from the themes to present a vision of individualistic, creativity-driven construction like these iconic ads from 1981. American journalist Henry Winsek, writing in 1987, even called the bricks, quote, "the raw material for a child's imagination to act upon, a creative material on par with clay, pen and pencil, paper mache, and wood," end quote. Hyperbole notwithstanding, this is a really evocative reminder of the long-running belief among many adults that particular kinds of self-directed play were truly essential to children's development. But by the turn of the millennium, Lego was firmly positioned as a ubiquitous part of middle-class childhood. However, as it began to expand into new fields like theme parks, apparel, and even video game design, the company faced criticism that it was losing sight of its core appeal. Lego had introduced its first licensed product line, Star Wars, in 1999, and also began shifting towards sets that had fewer and larger components and much less complexity built into them. And this was really an attempt to appeal to children who were less familiar or comfortable with the construction toy genre. And these design trends taken together created a kind of slippage between the company's continued narrative of creativity and the perceived triteness of these new products, a sort of problematic rift between what the public expected from Lego and what they thought the company now offered. After coming very close to a financial disaster in 2003, the company underwent a series of massive changes in its leadership and in internal organization, which were much covered then and since as the business press marvels at the near ruin and subsequent rebound of the company. On the level of design, the company's products and marketing in the past decade, so sort of post-crisis, allude to the complexity of defining creativity as a value in children's playthings today. In attempting to shed some of its more poorly conceived products of the early 2000s, Lego initially refocused on the city theme that had evolved out of the 1950s town plan. And Alexandra Lang, whom we'll hear from in just a moment, has written insightfully about the problematic kind of toy urbanism that Lego City now embodies, namely a disciplinarian boys' world populated almost entirely by construction zones and police stations. And just memorably coming from my own position as a museum professional, the only museum set that Lego has produced today showed the institution in question undergoing a robbery. So take that as you will. Nevertheless, these city sets represent classic Lego, truly the core of what the company is, for many customers. And you can see that in sort of especially heightened form here at Wright with this limited edition design with Keld reprising his role as a cover model. But perhaps thanks to this association between the company's history and these newer products, they've consistently been bestsellers among the company's product lines. In more recent years, the company's taken a sort of interesting turn. It's grafting the notion of creative building onto a really a sort of competitive bent in its products. With its buildable action figures, exoticizing setting, and corollary suite of licensed merchandise, Bionicle, launched in 2001, included a conflict-driven storyline released in periodic comic books installments and encouraged children to compete by collecting the sets. The sociologist Juliet Shore has pointed out in her book, Born to Buy, that LEGO's associations with wholesome construction play continued to work in its favor despite Bionicle's really kind of dark and violent nature. And the recent Ninjago theme further highlights the social and competitive play experiences that LEGO is increasingly building into its design. These sets incorporate an element of direct combat with these sort of specially designed spinner pieces, something of an allusion to classic toys like Tops or Marbles, set within this, you know, obviously very exoticizing setting as well. Carrying on the world-building and storytelling aspects of Bionicle, new product lines like these illustrate a growing tendency for LEGO to situate its physical toys within an immersive backstory, tying them to a rich company-designed narrative rather than the somewhat subtler genre cues of the earlier play themes. And I think this gives us a good opportunity to consider the distance between the company's pretensions toward universal creativity and then some of the realities of the marketplace. Most of the new products since the company's crisis have been very explicitly targeted at an audience of boys, but in 2011, LEGO released the Friends line, and I think you can see here, very obviously aimed at girls. Critics have derided the girl-coded color scheme, the redesigned feminine minifigures, and the apparent focus on home life, shopping, and beauty as sexist tropes that undermine the company's stated ideals. LEGO, in turn, has vigorously defended the sets, claiming to have designed them after several years of research and testing with girl builders. The ongoing debate about LEGO Friends, and it is totally ongoing, believe me, reveals how both how convinced many consumers remain by the company's evergreen ambitions of universality, and ultimately the inherent limitations of that ideal. LEGO's design and marketing in the past, you know, 10 years or so reveal a company attempting to adapt to what they see as a changing child, a somewhat elusive, digitally savvy consumer who's a bit of a mystery to toy designing adults. To address larger anxieties about childhood in the digital age, particularly this pervasive notion that children are getting older, younger, which, you know, we've heard for decades. It's not a recent phenomenon by any means. LEGO has conducted considerable consumer testing for its new products, foregrounding the children themselves as consumers and important economic agents. The result is a growing fragmentation of the bricks and the system into an ever more diverse and representationally specific subseries. But despite these licensing heavy offerings, and let's see, we have Harry Potter, we have Jurassic Park, we have Disney, we have Simpsons, we have Ninja Turtles, you get the picture. Despite these, you know, really heavy licensing arrangements from pop culture and frequent critiques of its design decisions, LEGO seems largely to have maintained its credibility within the public sphere as a purveyor of toys that foster and materialize children's imaginations. We can perhaps illuminate the durability of this image by examining some of the ways in which LEGO has moved into spaces outside of children's culture. Acting beyond the official marketing discourse of the company, adults have formed their own play traditions with the bricks, both reflecting and playfully distorting some of the conventions of the LEGO system that crop up in official company design. I want to briefly use LEGO's depictions of architecture as a lens to explore how the company's relationship to this adult community has grown in the past decades from relative obliviousness to a selective embrace. At the heart of this shift have been some specific efforts by the company to capture and capitalize on the goodwill and creativity of its adult devotees, extending its design and marketing beyond the strict sphere of childhood. One of LEGO's early and largely unsuccessful attempts at promoting the bricks for adult use was this 1963 scale model series, marketed explicitly as an architectural modeling tool for designers and hobbyists. With seemingly professional signifiers like a white and gray color palette and the modeling scales shown here, these sets drew upon contemporary trends in architecture in a somewhat curious effort to cast the bricks as tools for real-world design. The series, however, proved to be a flop and was discontinued after only 3 years. better luck next time. In the late 1980s and early 90s, however, a series of architectural exhibitions enthusiastically took up the plastic bricks as a medium of representation, pointing to a growing following among adults. The exhibitions invited architectural firms to submit designs for specific building types, like villas or abstract gates, and their entries closely paralleled the contemporaneous discourse of postmodernism in avant-garde design circles, including these sort of exaggerated references to historic forms, bold color and pattern, and an implicit rejection of modernist formalism. Many of the exhibiting architects noted that the use of a toy, as well as the speculative nature of the exhibition briefs, allowed them to be more playful and free in their work, echoing Lega's own rhetorical alignment between brick play and creativity. The bricks were also something of a rhetorical choice for the exhibition organizers. The introductory catalog essay for this show, for example, a 1984 exhibition in Rotterdam titled Architecture in Lego, expressed the hope that visitors would find the discipline more approachable through the familiar material of childhood. But while these exhibitions occurred with the official sanction of the company, they had little discernible effect on the company's own product designs or marketing. However, following the company's crisis in the early years of the new millennium, Lego's become increasingly open to the ideas and sort of on-the-ground expertise of its adult fans. Lego's architecture series of sets, for example, first released in 2008, were an outcome of the company's direct collaboration with an adult builder, the Chicago architect Adam Reed Tucker. Tucker initially caught Lego's notice with his impressive skyscraper constructions, seen here at left, in a more recent project. This was post-partnership, but he was doing this, you know, same sort of massive detailed building before that. And he pitched the company an idea for a series of sets with miniature buildings. Lego worked with him to create a small pilot run, and the product line took off immediately. And you can find it today across the park in the Met gift shop at the Guggenheim. It's really entered a sort of interesting high culture space. And the restrained design language of the sets and the packaging, which you can see at right, implies the sort of sophisticated audience. And the sets are priced significantly higher than similarly sized products aimed at kids. The architecture series thus takes advantage of adults' greater spending power, but it also benefits from the overlapping motivations of childhood nostalgia and the sort of cool factor of Lego's recurring associations with the architecture and design professions. The creativity of adult fans of Lego, or AFALS as they call themselves, it's a particularly acronym-heavy community, has taken many forms and become increasingly visible in the age of social media, encompassing community-organized conventions, countless stop-motion brick films on YouTube, massive detailed constructions, and even participatory art installations. And if you go down to the High Line before, I think, September 25th or something like that, you can participate in Olafur Eliasson's collectivity project with all-white Lego. Amid what media and education scholar David Buckingham has called the reduced scope for innovation that many toy manufacturers face in a media and licensing-driven commercial landscape, Lego's embrace of AFAL's creativity is another opportunity to reassert the company's public image of universal inventiveness by broadcasting its interest, although very selectively, of course, in what and how its fans build. Lego is able to simultaneously celebrate, direct, and profit from its most devoted and vocal customers. And perhaps nowhere has Lego's firm footing in popular culture and the pervasive mythos of creativity it has built around itself been more evident than in the 2014 film, The Lego Movie. Now, without spoiling it for those of you who haven't seen the film, directed by Phil Lord and Christopher Miller, the story centers on a core lesson of creative expression through building, arguing that sticking to what's on the box is self-limiting and antithetical to the spirit of the bricks. And the film was both a, you know, popular and hugely popular and critical success, with many reviewers expressing a sort of wonder that what was essentially a feature-length toy commercial managed to provide an engaging story and enough winking references to pop culture that it kept adult viewers engaged as well as kids. And in what should be no real surprise, the movie has also boosted Lego sales considerably, especially of Lego sets themed around the characters and vehicles from the movie. So there's an interesting meta lesson there. But that this filmic message should come from a company whose financial interests require its customers to buy products based precisely on what's on the box is an essential irony of the film. But perhaps it also illuminates that the dichotomy drawn between abstract, educative construction play and the more narrative or genre or character-driven toys of the company's recent past is maybe not quite so stark as many commentators posit. As design historian Judy Hatfield has argued, there's, quote, little point in only casting toys as producers of specific effects. Toys cannot fully determine actions or thoughts. They are themselves the focus of play, a dynamic activity used to rehearse, interpret, and try out new meanings, end quote. In looking at the company's long history, then, it appears that LEGO's shifting design language has allowed it to blur many of these categories typically imposed on children's playthings, and around which so many of the debates among parents and educators and child psychologists have circulated. So while this ideal of creativity can prove somewhat amorphous and is always rooted in deeper cultural questions about the nature of childhood, LEGO has built its seeming ubiquity and beloved status within the material culture of modern childhood on the back of this enduring value. Thank you. Yes.
I had one comment, which is it's sort of interesting, full circle of what we saw this morning, is that they have Legoland, and they have Titania's Palace.
Absolutely.
One of the great dollhouses, early wonderful houses, early 20th century, and that they have a respect for the past of toy collecting and history. And I wanted to ask you how you see that in what they're doing now and their philosophy and in why they collected that collection.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, that's sort of an interesting point. And I think it comes out of a very explicit effort the company has made to tie itself into this longer history of whether it's the dollhouse or older construction toys, like, you know, going back to the Anker blocks from Richter's in Germany in the late 19th century. I tried to show in the very early marketing materials, they're consciously putting themselves in that frame of reference. In terms of their more recent activity, I think the company is sort of seeing it both ways. They're seeing this character-driven, this licensing-heavy, you know, opportunities as ways to make a lot of money and make some kids happy. But then they have this much more serious notion of architecture and building that you see in the architecture series. I didn't put it up on the slide, but in 2013 they released a set they called the Architecture Studio, which was, they see it as the direct inheritor of that 60s scale model series. It's all white Legos, it's, you know, the self-serious, use these bricks for architecture. They're trying to sort of do a double act with that, and again, I think it's working. You know, just last year they superseded Mattel to become the biggest toy maker by sales, so... Whatever they're doing it right, as far as the market's concerned. Yes?
Just to follow that point, there really are two, but it's like a parallel universe, because I mean, even though they're doing their branding and providing the next set of blocks, the kids are dumping them into one box and creating their own, they're constantly using their own imaginations all along, so no matter what the manufacturer's doing, they're going to reconstruct from their own industry.
Precisely.
I mean, at least the children that I've been involved with.
Yeah, and I think the company sees that as a sort of, it sees it as a good thing. You know, that's the message underlying a lot of these things. And going back to the play, the principles of play in 1962, this idea of the more Lego, the better its value. So that's how they're sort of reconciling that, I guess, is that we want you to buy these sets with these evocative, exotic themes, because then you'll get the cool pieces that then you can use to build whatever comes out of your imagination. Yes?
I'm familiar with the controversy of the Friends line as far as parents of girls, but I wonder when Lego started to diversify into these theme-driven things, a lot of which have guns and jails and things you could argue skew more towards boys, were parents of young boys frustrated at all that they felt like their sons were also being divided from a gender-neutral sort of play?
Yeah, I think that's one of the interesting things that has come out of the whole debate around the Friends, is that what we think of as gender-neutral toys are often very sort of implicitly coded as boy toys. But then in a lot of cases, the explicitly boy ones are limiting what boys can do, because what if someone doesn't want to be a policeman or a fireman? So that has been a part of the debate, and I think the hope among some of these advocates and parents who are arguing against the sort of pink Lego idea is that you don't have to divide the universes. You can have a shopping mall that isn't pink. You can have you can have women police officers in the police set. And so that there has been this sort of grassroots effort to get the company to sort of integrate these things. How much that will happen is anybody's guess. I think there's a statistic that's come from the company itself, so take it with a grain of salt. But after the Friends line was released, the number of sets that were sold to girls tripled almost overnight. So, you know, we as adults and as parents, we want to live in this gender-neutral universe. We want to provide this value for our children, but it seems that the market, whoever is actually buying these sets, is convinced by some of this sort of differentiation.
I just wonder if I could put you two in conversation here, because I know that you've, this question of quietness, right, that they're really selling in the 60s, is something that I know Rob has also worked on regarding the kind of Vietnam era of toys, and I wonder if maybe you could suggest what you think quietness is all about, and if you wouldn't mind, Rob, maybe responding.
Okay. Yeah, there's another ad that I had to take out because of time, as always. It's from the Samsonite era. I think it was issued in the U.S. in late 60s. I'm forgetting the exact year, but it literally, the copy reads, "Lego, the quiet toy. There are other toys that, you've seen this ad. There are other toys that go rat-a-tat-tat and bang and boom, but this isn't one of them." So it's very much pushing this message of nonviolence, and in that context, it's very much like an anti Vietnam message. And but you can see it's happening earlier as well, so I think it comes out of this family values notion that the kids should be playing quietly on the floor while mother does her sewing in the chair. It's very rooted in that sort of trope.
You know, that's an ad that I've talked about. I wrote about in my own research.
Oh, cool.
But that particular ad.
Yeah.
But it actually, you're remembering the wording exactly, except for at the top, it actually says peace.
Oh, yes, of course.
Right? And it says, okay, let somebody else get their adventure out of a gun sight. Let somebody else's kid, which is interesting.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. Let somebody else's
Someone else's
kid
children.
It.
The other children. Right?
Yeah,
so
children who
are
going to be
I
sent
think.
To war.
Yeah.
So I looked at it as a class issue.
Absolutely.
As part
yeah.
of the discussion about debates about war toys during that moment.
Mm-hmm.
And Legos. I couldn't get access to either the creators of that ad. I could find their names, but they wouldn't call
mm-hmm.
me. Anybody know? and I couldn't get any archival research.
Mm-hmm.
I'd love to talk to you about it, how you got some of this stuff. But
I
guessed that what was happening is they were seeing a couple of other companies that are catering to the same upper middle class,
mm-hmm.
Urban, educated, milieu, that these other companies were doing that.
Yeah.
And that
no,
there was an
exactly
overlap
right.
between those companies, the targeted demographic, consumer demographic of those upper middle class
mm-hmm.
companies, and the anti-war toy movement, which
right.
is gathering steam in the U.S. in 64, 65.
Right.
And that I first comes out in late 65, and it's only in, I think, the LA Times, the New Yorker.
Yeah.
That's it.
So the audience is very clear there.
Exactly.
Yeah.
It's funny, too, with the introduction of the play theme sets in 1978, you're getting these, pirate ships where the pirates have swords and little 18th century pistols. And the company does this amazing sort of mental gymnastics with that, where they say, well, it's okay for the fantasy lines to have weapons because it's fantasy. It's not real. Children know the difference. For the city lines, the sort of the real world representations, if you will, they have very explicitly avoided that, and that's resulted in a sort of macabre cottage industry in recent years of fans 3D printing their own incredibly detailed Lego firearms.
They take over the museum?
Yeah, it's really, there is just desire among a lot of people for violent Lego, and it's just funny how that doesn't mesh so well with the marketing. Yes?
Not to contradict anything that you've said about the quiet Lego
mm-hmm.
in the Vietnam era, but just to add to it, because I don't think there's usually one monolithic motivation for behaviors like this.
Oh, absolutely.
For one thing, we've got this, it's nice and quiet, and
orderly, and children are not being rambunctious, very much pre-Vietnam in these ads. And in fact, one of the emphases of the German pedagogues in the progressive era, in the late 19th century era, is make a quiet room in the house for the children to play in, so mother can supervise them and they can be nurtured, and don't turn them loose in the streets where who knows who they're playing with and what kinds of working class problems they're becoming a culture to, and that sort of thing. So Denmark's not far from Germany.
No, and that's really where this whole idea of architectural toys comes out of, is that, you know, keep the child in the interior, keep them in the home, in this sort of quiet occupation that they can do for hours while the adults do, you know, get things done. So yeah, you're totally right.
Literally, the quiet, secluded aspect of that is really
Page, actually, Hilary Page, the British designer, in the same book, Playtime in the First 5 Years, writes exactly about that, how the child should have a quiet room, no radio, no television, you know, they should have this protected space, the sort of nurturing, womb-like space, if you will, for play.
Let's make a comment to what he said, which is also that from Germany, you have a lot of tin toys that are very much action toys, and a lot of militaristic toys, tremendous amount, both World War I, World War II, every part of the army, and not only that, but you have even earlier in the dollhouse world, miniature dolls in every regiment of Germany in military gear.
Wow.
For your most elegant dollhouse, you have a soldier who also comes to dinner. So, okay, there's
an
a very, very strong, yes, in every, you know, with swords and the whole thing, and they're in little girls' dollhouses.
Wow.
So, it's,
it runs deep.
Yes,
yeah.
So it's not such quiet. I mean, well, you know, the dollhouse dolls maybe, but so much the militaristic toys are very militaristic.
Mm-hmm.
I was also thinking about the digital extension of this, of building bricks on a computer now. There was, I think when this first started, there was an ad about, talking about quiet, there's no more stepping on blocks and the bricks in the middle of the night.
Right.
So,
which we all
have.
It's terrible.
But I mean, it's that extension of what's going to happen now when you're building, or what is the difference when you're building
digitally. Yeah, and that's sort of an interesting thread that, again, just I didn't go into here, but early in that same sort of pre-crisis moment, right around the turn of the millennium, the Lego was really trying to enter this space of digital play and create a system where kids could build with these bricks in a digital space. And they rolled out a couple of sort of tentative attempts at that software, but their sort of design ambitions, they wanted to have the same notion of quality in that digital play experience, and the technology just wasn't there.
But the work they did at MIT with Seymour Papert, the Storm,
that's a great sort of other train of thought. They've been involved with MIT in sort of early, very early conversations around teaching kids computer programming as well. And that's morphed into the Mindstorms language, which is about robotics and, you know, creating your own sort of wonderful technical.
It's also about invention.
Yeah, absolutely. And finding the way to use this flexible plastic system to you know, alter your world in real ways.
Where is Lego made these days?
They have production facilities in the Czech Republic. There's still one in Billund in Denmark. And they are, I think, just recently opened one in somewhere in Asia as well, because that's what they see as the next market. You know, they're starting to really roll out there. But it is still, I think, largely rooted in sort of Northern and Central Europe.
Okay, it's 3 o'clock.
Dwell Magazine, Design Observer, and many other publications. She's the architecture critic for Curbed and an opinion columnist for Design. She has a 2005 PhD from the Institute of Fine Arts at NYU, and she was a Loeb Fellow at the Graduate School of Design at Harvard in 2014. Lang is the author of 3 books, including a monograph on the renowned shop design research, a critical history and handbook to writing about architecture, and an e-book, The .com City, Silicon Valley Urbanism. Her paper today, is after wood, the plastic and the digital in contemporary toys. Alexandra.
Okay. Hi. Thanks so much for inviting me to be part of this. I feel like I've learned so much already. And while, as we learned in the last lecture, toys are supposed to be fun, I think it's great to be in a room full of people who also take toys seriously, which is something that does not always happen in the real world. So here we have some more Lego, but I'm not going to spend too much time on Lego. Love Lego but hate plastic? Asked Apartment Therapy in 2013. Just one of more than a dozen design blogs to feature wooden Lego blocks made by Mokulak, which you see here on the right. Described as handmade and all natural, the 8 stud size blocks have a clear visual appeal in a minimalist Muji way, and came packaged in a brown cardboard box with an unbleached cotton sack for storage. One commenter dreamed of brick and concrete varieties as well to teach children about real building materials, never mind the difficulty of making those materials in miniature form. But beyond the block's good looks lurked some very basic questions of function. Design Boom noted that there was a product disclaimer that the pieces can warp or fit together imprecisely due to the nature of the material in different temperatures and scale of humidity. Another commentator brought up sustainability, considering the sheer number of Lego blocks produced a year. Are Legos even Legos without the universal snap-together property? Do toys need to be as artisanal as our food? And I understand my child would want to make his own toy out of wood, but does someone else need to do it for him? What is it about wood? The essays in Swedish Wooden Toys, as well as some of the previous talks today, have pointed to several answers to the question of why you would take a toy as long-lived and popular as Lego, 36 billion bricks per year and 600 billion in circulation, a toy whose design and industrial production were predicated on finding the right plastic, and turn it into a wooden toy. Wood in Sweden has particular nationalist connotations and was for many years a major national resource. And so toys there made of wood appeared at both the high and low ends of the market, from carved and painted, handmade and homemade toys to the high gloss polish of Brio. But as noted in the introduction, wood also carries a cultural meaning of timelessness and quality that stretches beyond Sweden's borders, and in the post-war period to many other northern industrialized countries. Amy Ogata quotes, "The veneration of the wooden toy was and has remained international." In designing The Creative Child, she also noted that Roland Barthes characterized plastic and metal as graceless and chemical, and argued that wood is a familiar and poetic substance which does not sever the child from close contact with the tree, the table, the floor. Wood does not wound or break down, it does not shatter, it wears out, it can last a long time. In the US, Dr. Spock argued for the abstracted wooden train over the realistic metal one, while Creative Playthings, which you see here, an early educational toy store and catalog, combined furniture and toy in the hollow block, which you see on the right, maple cubes, which were open on one side, that could be used for storage or for fort making. And this image is of them in use at Marcel Breuer's house in the museum garden at the Museum of Modern Art. But as I make my own way through the forest of gendered toy aisles and museum gift shops, as a design critic and parent, or should it be a parent and design critic, I begin to push back against the association of wood with the wholesome, the educational, and the high class. As a material, wood limits toys by weight, by connectivity, and by cost. And as a cultural idea, it limits the aesthetics of toys to a narrow range of shapes and colors, sometimes reducing playability and pedagogical value in favor of a mid-century design look. In the play testing facility I call my living room, I have found greater playability and durability over time in a number of plastic toys, and found the creativity, spatial exploration, and role-playing that were part of the early Swedish toys in the digital realm, sometimes still made in Sweden. As I was putting together this talk, I kept returning to a quote by Charles Eames from the beginning of the Eames' take on toys, the short film Toccata for Toy Trains. In that film, there's a voiceover at the beginning that says, "In a good old toy, there's apt to be nothing self-conscious about the use of materials. What is wood is wood. What is tin, what is cast is beautifully cast. It is possible that somewhere in all this is a clue to what sets the creative climate of any time, including our own." I've never felt that I entirely understood this quote, and maybe this is something we can discuss in the panel in case any of you feel like you do. But here and in this context, it seemed to me an argument not typically made by mid-century modernist designers that toys have their own truth to materials, that a tin steam engine, detailed, you know, as has been denigrated in the past, may be better than a wooden one, or a plastic socket joint better than a wooden one, because they provide an easier path between the toy and the child's creative imagination. So in order to start kind of opening a discussion about how toys made of other materials can be good, I want to talk on about some bad wooden toys. This is Automoblocks. I don't know how many of you are familiar with this. Three different people gave me sets of this after I had a little boy. So Automoblocks shares the traits of many toys sold at places like Fat Brain Toys, the MoMA Design Store, and the Overplayed Kid Boutiques in my neighborhood. They're made of wood. The colors are bright and unisex. They use no batteries. They formally evoke the past. And they cost significantly more than the plastic, pink or blue, light blinking, noise blinking blobs sold at Toys R Us. And yet my son seemed perplexed by how to play with them, beyond rolling them back and forth. And I think I have to say I feel the same way about those Play Sam cars and trucks that are in the show and in the catalog, which I've never really figured out what you do with them after you roll them back and forth. Which is something that any die-cast drugstore school bus can do. Automoblocks promises creativity. With Automoblocks, your child plays outside the box and builds the design pictured in his or her mind. Putting thinking outside the box brings a workplace cliche down to the preschool set and indicates the anxiety behind many educational toy choices. But more immediately, the design options are severely limited. You can exchange a sporty rear end for a utilitarian one, a green transparent cab for a purple one, or one set of colored tiles for another. But whatever you do, you get another car. It took my husband's outside the box thinking to make the whole thing into a flatbed with two axles in the center sections from about six different cars. But then we had a pile of unusable spare parts, including the wheels, which seemed designed to be lost under the sofa and which cost $10 for replacements. The box promised interchangeability, but all that changed was color, not function. So Automoblocks, it seemed to me, are really like dolls for the car obsessed. All you can do is change their outfits. So if Automoblocks do too little, many updated versions of classic wooden toys do too much. House Industries' Alexander Girard alphabet blocks would not fly in many classrooms. I showed them to one Montessori teacher, and she said, "For a child learning how to read or spell, the letters are too stylized. There's also no reason for the colors. It isn't a system. The vowels aren't all in one color, for example." The blocks combine too many different systems. A puzzle showing an architectural scene, a rainbow of colors, different lettering styles, and Girard's version of dingbats. So these are really another trophy for adults, one that would look good piled artfully on the bookshelf next to your white Lego model of the Farnsworth house. And yet they have proved successful enough that House Industries, the company that makes them, has made more sets of blocks that aren't for children, including this Eames House set and one on a Neutra theme. So do children really want to build the Eames house? One suspects that all of these architects were given plain wooden blocks as children. So I would say the Eameses themselves got closer to the truth of their materials when it came to toys, with their own capital T toy, manufactured by Tigrette Enterprises in 1951, which offered children the chance to make their own prefabricated structure, closer in spirit to the Eames house, which could have been, but never was, taken apart and put back together as a different form of house. The toy combined thin wooden dowels, pipe cleaners, and a set of square and triangular stiffened paper panels in green, yellow, blue, red, magenta, and black. Children could run the dowels through the sleeves on the edges of the panels to strengthen them, and then attach them via struts at the corners. Initially sold in a big flat box via the Sears catalog, the Eames soon redesigned the packaging as well, creating a far more elegant 30-inch hexagonal tube into which all the parts could be rolled and stored. The first version of the toy made spaces big enough to for children to inhabit, and you see, you know, Ray Eames building them in their backyard here. But a smaller version called the Little Toy, which you see on the right, released in 1952, was scaled more like an architectural model and allowed children to radically reinterpret the dollhouse, another area of contemporary toys that needs rethinking. A third category of bad wooden toy is toys that ape the looks of brands like Brio and Plan Toys at a fraction of the cost by using cheap wood, untraceable paint, and other overdetermined brand extensions. Here I'm talking primarily about Melissa and Doug. Their logo, which you can see on the end of the wagon, I don't know how clear it is, looks handwritten, and their packages say handcrafted, whatever that means. But the toys are made in factories in China, where the Connecticut-based company has little to no oversight over potential hazards in the paint and metal parts of their wooden toys. A 2013 article in the New York Times on Melissa and Doug, who are real people, and their own children, had the headline, "No tie-ins, no touchscreens, no apps," presenting their company as wholesome and timeless and a bulwark against the digital age. But even without tie-ins, wooden toys can be just as gender role reinforcing as plastic ones. These are two other less Brio aping products from the Melissa and Doug line. And they chase trends just as readily. We were given a number of Melissa and Doug toys when my kids were smaller that looked like classics, stackable trucks, magnetic paper dolls, superhero costumes, that ended up at the bottom of the toy chest because they couldn't connect to other universes, had a limited range of activity, or were confiscated by me for blatant sexism, as with these two examples. So two of my favorite plastic building toys, which are sturdy, good-looking, and long-playing, are Zoob and Magnetiles, both of which spur construction projects that include 30 and 45 degree angles, as well as joints and rotation, rather than stacks and lines. They may teach less than a plain wood Kapla block about gravity, but they are also lighter weight and easier for small hands to manipulate, opening the making of structures up to a wider range of ages and creating a wider range of results. Perhaps part of the answer to why girls aren't using Lego more or blocks more is not to color them pink, but to think of a different range of objects that can be built. So Zoob, which you see here, is a set of plastic ball and socket joints that can be combined in various ways. And there are essentially four different types of pieces, each one corresponding to a different color, some with balls on both ends, some with a ball and socket on both ends, and so on. So they are easy to snap together, though sometimes hard for three-year-olds to pry apart, as is Lego, if you don't have fingernails. But Zoob, rather than suggesting buildings as an end result, suggests creatures, manipulable skeletons that can switch from insects to dinosaurs to men in just a few clicks. I've been amazed to walk into my son's room and find the floor suddenly covered in alien beings. And because the individual parts are small, but not so small as to be choking hazards, and basic sets are relatively cheap. The range of scale you can achieve is really terrific. Zoob was created by an artist named Michael Joaquin Gray in 1997, and period articles from that year include one called that with the title, My Zoob Can Beat Up Your Lego. And these sets have already won a number of toy awards. Gray has said that his toy was specifically created to model biological and network systems and fill a hole in existing building sets. Newer Lego products like Bionicles, which you can see here on the right, employ similar ball and socket joint strategies, but in a far more narrative-specific and violent way. The history of wooden toys includes a number of attempts to create sets to build figures and branching structures. So I also include this one from the Swedish Wooden Toys catalog, the Mickey Cool, as well as, you know, more common American things like Tinker Toys. Magnetiles, another favorite toy, are thin, flat plastic sandwiches which come in translucent or opaque sets and have bar magnets set around the edges. The magnets are thoroughly encased, and the tiles are bigger than your mouth, so these are not a choking hazard like many other magnetic toys. Magnetiles are easier to put together than Lego, and you can make something tall and beautiful in a flash. As kids get older, they tend to move beyond the basic squares, which come in two sizes, and start thinking about the possibilities of the triangles, matching them into squares when they run out, creating geodesic hovercraft, bugs, spaceships, and even tensegrity-type towers. Magnetiles were invented by a Japanese math teacher in 1992, and he intended them to teach the possibility of geometry. And I have to say that anything you make with magnetiles, even the little cubes made by my two-year-old at the time, looks beautiful. So there's something about this toy, I think, that manages not to, you know, disrupt the adult aesthetic ideal while providing a wider range of play. In my house, we now have 300 pieces through a combination of gifts, hand-me-downs, and purchases, which means that's $300 worth of magnetiles. They are quite expensive. But I have to say that we've gotten at least 7 play years out of them. I recently backed a Kickstarter for this product called Sankakumodo, which is a thin plastic mosaic-making toy that you can stick to the window, created by a Dutch designer named Samira Boone, that reminded me a lot of magnetiles in its simplicity and transparency, though it operates creatively only in two dimensions. So, in the 1964 film Mary Poppins, all it takes is a snap of the nanny's fingers and the toys march into the toy box, the clothes fold themselves, and the covers ripple up the beds. What the song argues is that for kids, housework should be a game. Toca House, which you see here, which is an Apple Store app from the Swedish digital play studio Toca Boca, understands the fun in these adult jobs. Players scroll up and down a tall, narrow house, selecting first a room and then a task. And if you look second from right, that is the kitchen, which I was thinking of all this morning during the play kitchen lecture, because it really is a very similar setup, isn't it, in that vignette. And Toca Boca also makes a separate kitchen game, and now I wish I'd brought a slide of that, which allows you to put things in pans, put things in blenders, and really kind of imitates the same play idea as those play kitchens. And the same is true of Toca House. You just have more rooms to play with. I have to say, as somebody who hates ironing, ironing in Toca House is incredibly satisfying. So what can you do in Toca House? You can clean the windows. You see a dirty window, and there's like a white paper towel, and you move it with your finger all over the window. And the minute the whole window is clean, there's this sort of sparkling noise, sort of celebratory noise, and then you move on to your next task. To dry the clothes, you lift each shirt or socks, again with your finger on the screen, to a pair of pins on a clothesline. It makes a little clicking sound, and then the clothesline moves over, and then you move the next one up. So it's all very simply and elegantly designed with a number of noise cues to let you know that you've done it right. My children, when I downloaded this game at first, my children took to it so quickly, as they have with the rest of the ever-expanding Toka universe. And it took me some time to realize that it had some subversive qualities in the world of children's media. This is another one of their apps called Toka Town. First, your avatar choices include a giant yellow monster wearing a flower wreath, a little boy in a red t-shirt, and a creature whose head looks like a pink house. There are no aprons, no nannies, no licensed characters, and you can play it forever, moving from room to room or task to task, rewarded only by that little trumpet fanfare. Third, that's it. It's just a house. It doesn't do a thousand things. So if elegance is refusal, I felt that Toka Boca was my first encounter with elegance in the App Store. So many Toka Boca apps are specifically based on the popular toys of my own 1970s childhood, made out of primary color plastic by Fisher-Price or Little Tykes. This is a Fisher-Price cash register from Etsy. Toka Boca co-founder Emil Ovomar did much of the company's research by ordering old toy catalogs from eBay. Why is that still fun? The designers asked of the tea set, the Frisbee, Monopoly, and then what's intrinsically there that could be transferred to the screen. In the Swedish Wooden Toys catalog, one essay notes the early appearance of role-playing toys like the loom based around housekeeping, primarily intended for girls. Toka House is one of the few times I've seen housework presented in a non-gendered way. Toka Boca's founder also told me that many of their toys, they don't call them games because that to them suggests competition and the kind of larger gaming market, have proved popular for children with autism because a toy like Toka House allows kids with autism to practice everyday tasks without real-world frustration. I also found a contemporary equivalent to one... an old equivalent to one of my favorite contemporary digital toys on page 122 of the catalog in Brio's beautiful wooden labyrinth, which we saw earlier today. The labyrinth, as Amy said this morning, was introduced in 1946 and was one of the company's most successful exports. It was designed for adults and often used in its early days by soldiers recuperating from war wounds or fighter pilots who had to while away the hours. So too was Monument Valley, which you can see a still from on the right, which is an addictive spatial puzzle-solving app, now just over a year old, that's clocked 4 million downloads and counting. Maybe our spare time is spent in transit today, but we seem no less interested in finding our way through labyrinth after labyrinth on the lightweight territory of our screens. I spoke to Neil McFarland, the director of games at Us2, Monument Valley's maker, and found his design goals very much in sync with the modernist and minimalist aesthetic of the post-war wooden toy. He told me, there's very little in the levels that is superfluous. There are no achievements in the game, no unlockables, no secrets. We really wanted it to be just about the experience of traveling through these monuments and nothing else. So here's another still on the right from Monument Valley and a drawing by M.C. Escher that was very inspirational for the designers. So he went on to tell me, we plundered different architectural styles. It started out with Islamic domes and then after that the castles. A lot of it is just changing the shape of the rooftop because essentially everything is made out of squares and cubes, as in your basic block set. During the design process, the team experimented with more texture and detail and scale information, but found it was distracting to players. And they user tested every level to be challenging, but not impossible. So the first member of my family to unlock the last labyrinth was, perhaps not surprisingly, my 8-year-old. But Us2 never tested this game on children. They tested it on people that were 18 and up and marketed it for adults. But because it's wordless, and after all, it's just a spatial puzzle, Monument Valley has proved incredibly popular with kids who are also building their own labyrinths in games like Minecraft. The game follows the law of physics to a point, and then abandons them in favor of its own consistent but fantastical rules. The finger that taps the path for Princess Ida, let's see, can you see Princess Ida? Not in this one. Oh, wait, I can't see it at this angle. Yeah, yeah. She's like a little Alice figure in a hat. is no less connected to the brain than the hand that turns the knob on the labyrinth, though I think the latter may require more fine motor skills. So when the makers and promoters of wooden toys dismiss everything plastic or everything digital as having the same low value, they place too much weight, as Barth did, on some intrinsic property of wood. Setting wood aside, I believe, would allow historians and critics to better see the relationship between child and toy without adult, often class-based value systems getting in the way. By focusing on play values, what part of the brain is fired by a toy, how long it can be played with, how many different possibilities it opens, rather than primary colors or natural materials, we can begin to develop criteria for evaluating the next generation of good toys after wood. Thank you.
Our panel.
Well, did you look at SimCity or any of those aspects of?
You know, I haven't yet. I have to say that the digital games that I've looked at most closely are the ones that my children have picked up, and they are too young for SimCity, and I was too old for SimCity, so I don't have a lot of personal experience with it, but. You're totally right that there's a continuum of kind of plate, you could call it even placemaking games, mm-hmm. that like a deeper history would definitely be included in it.
Well, not to be romantic about wood, but yeah. Wood does, I'm a designer too, so, but hardwood particularly has weight, and I think that something that plastic doesn't have, well, I mean it could have if you have weights in it, but and I think when young children are really interested in building and constructing things, weight is really important. But it's different. So I think having a combination, I mean, to have a wooden blocks and plastic blocks and foam blocks, and so children see the difference in the material. But wood is different. Yeah. And it's that's I mean it has an affordance or a quality I think that's really important. That's not about romance or.
Yeah. Well, I don't disagree with that. I think I just. Found again in my own play and then the play of my children that they didn't like the wooden blocks. Like I mean it was, and I don't know, maybe I had very weak children, but they actually found them difficult to deal with in a way that I'd never really heard talked about, and so I felt that the lightweightness of plastic actually helped them like get to more interesting play and more interesting building faster. And that may be a personal circumstance, but I also felt like I hadn't really heard a discussion of wood as being heavy, as, you know, a plus and a minus in terms of the discussion of the toys and sort of the design of them. I think, was there a question in the back?
Yeah. Wooden Legos that you showed earlier. Yeah. Would have to be so terribly well made to fit together. Was the cost kind of prohibitive when those came out?
Yeah, I mean, those are totally a design store toy, like the expensive, yeah, like Play Sam, or like the expensive Lego sets. I think, you know, what makes me keep returning to them as an example was that at least in the realm of the digital picture, they seem tremendously appealing to people. Like they sort of went viral as a toy that I feel like from a design perspective is rather ridiculous. I mean, you know, it's kind of antithetical to the basic idea of Lego. So it was this question of why are people falling in love with this thing that is actually so problematic from a design point of view? And cost is among the design considerations indeed.
So briefly ping back to the SimCity idea, its designer Will Wright actually thought of himself as a creator of software toys rather than games, which really, you know, the rhetoric surrounding Monument Valley just immediately tipped that off for me. Mm-hmm. So I also just had a wondered if you could muse a little bit about how Minecraft fits into this from your perspective. We talked a little bit about it at lunch,
yeah.
But just how it sort of fits against this notion of craft, but in a digital space as well.
Yeah, I think Minecraft is really interesting and something that, you know, I would like to know more about in relation to Minecraft is are people looking at the difference maybe between weighted and weightless building? Because, you know, in Minecraft, you can build your tower however high, you can build it out of emeralds, I feel like the things kids build in Minecraft are often very tacky because they have an infinite number of materials to choose from, so they choose them all, and then sort of bears no relation. I mean, at least in like their initial play, it bears no relation to, you know, anything you would do in life. So, I mean, I think Minecraft is tremendously interesting. Like, so many kids are using it. I think they're getting a lot of the same kind of joy in making things themselves, exploring a world, all of that. Also, you know, you had those pictures of kids playing collaboratively with Lego. Minecraft is actually quite collaborative. A lot of the little kids join worlds, and so they're building together in the world of their iPad. So I feel like it has the potential to have, you know, kind of all of the same qualities that we associate with Lego and then earlier wooden blocks. The one sort of question in my mind is like, is there inherent value in, you know, building here rather than like in here? Like, what does that do differently in your mind? And I feel like that's a deeper question that I hope, you know, education researchers are looking into. But I feel like, I mean, maybe it's sort of like what Karen was just saying, that the best thing is to be using all of these building toys in tandem and without judgment, which I think is how a lot of kids are using them, because their parents buy them Legos and then their friends talk about Minecraft, and so it's kind of all mixed up together if you're a kid that wants to build at all, which right. Not all kids want to do anyway. So, yeah.
Great, thank you.
I have a question about not necessarily a toy, but materials, which hasn't, I don't think it's been discussed today, which is basically clay and Play-Doh and things that, you know, kids play with and create with, and in a way it's a much more kind of physical materiality that really, more so than blocks and Legos and things, actually allows maybe for, in some ways, the most free expression, because you can not only make whatever you want, but in some cases, if you have the type of clay, you can see the transformation from, you know, the metamorphosis from one type of material to then a different type. And it also connects to kind of one of the oldest, you know, forms of creation, creating with clay. So I'm just curious about where where that fits in with the kind of the plastic versus wood versus other kinds of materials.
Yeah, I can't answer that question at all, but I feel like there are probably other people in this room that could, or, I mean, I guess I know I see clay as more connected to art education, but I don't know if that's been true historically, and I don't know, is there anyone else here that has looked at that, or, no? Sorry. Yeah.
I'm an architect, and I've sort of been on the fringes of architecture in different mediums and professions. I'm curious as to if anyone in the room, or if you know, if the Japanese have developed toys in a way that in a sense reflects their very visceral, and I would say emotional, connection to the physical world. I mean, they are absolutely the polar opposite of sort of Western thinking in terms of a reciprocity between the person, and I'm assuming the child, and the very visceral physical world on an emotional basis. I mean, from what Karen was saying about weight, to material, to engagement, in terms of like what the body does, you know, perceptions.
Yeah. That's an interesting question, but I really don't know the answer.
Do you know the answer?
I don't know the answer, but I'm going to ask a different question, okay. Which is, so Bach's quote comes out of this rise of plastic.
Yes.
He's obviously pairing plastic and wood together, and,
yeah.
You know, likes wood better. So in our world, is this the same, in a sense, discourse that in the media era, you know, in this digital world, that we have re-venerated wood and the Melissa and Doug? Is it also, you know, is the romance of wood kind of re-enchanted by the presence and ubiquity of the digital?
Oh yeah, I think so, definitely. I mean, just like that, I was looking up an article about Melissa and Doug just to make sure I had the facts about them right, and the article that I came across had that headline, which is specifically positioning their company, which is essentially trying to bring the price of wood and toys down, and hence some other values down too, as the opposite of the digital world, as the opposite of Disney, and I think kind of contained in Disney is plastic and mass market toys. So yeah, I think the same perhaps fear of plastic in the post-war era is now reinscribed as a fear of the digital. So, and that's why it's so interesting to find these digital toys that you think, well, this is doing the same thing. I mean, it's different, but it's the same. And so really, maybe we should be talking again about like the mode of play rather than what's it made of.
Okay. Good. Thank you.
Yeah, go ahead. I talked to Colin Wilson about this, but it seems to me that all of the talk has kind of like touched on the importance of the role of women. And I guess without necessarily like really focusing on it, like in terms of the Nuremberg kitchens, like, you know, let's think about how these girls are playing this and how they're going to like how this is setting up for women, and then particularly the Vienna-Werkstatt, the way in which the Eugenia can be saved, and how, you know, how she was such an important figure, and then you know, the dolls, the black dolls, like the way in which, you know, these are four girls and to make them like this, you know, role model, and then the women pictured in the advertisements for Lego, and this idea of like peace in the home and their responsibility in particular. And I don't know, I guess for Alexander, just kind of your role as like a design historian and also like mother, and how this kind of like informed your own work. So I don't know, it was just something that kind of came out to me. I don't know if that's of interest to anyone, but just, maybe that's not a question, it's more a comment. Apologies. I'm not sure if this is something that you've all thought about, or just kind of the role of kind of, yeah, women as a way it weaves through this kind of narrative of toys.
I mean, I can answer for myself that, like, in a way I've struggled with this interest of mine in toys and other, you know, kind of products for children since I became a parent, because I wasn't interested in it before, and then you're plunged into this world of products, and if you're a critic, it's impossible not to be bothered by them, not to kind of like pick them up and play with them yourself and say, you know, this is, you know, this is fun, this is not fun, and all of that. But then I've had, you know, a fear that this work would be considered, you know, too light or too marginal or only of interest to mothers or something like that. And so I think I've purposely not, I mean, I've written about gender and toys, but I also want to make sure as I write about toys that I'm writing about a lot of other issues too, because I feel like that could go in one direction quickly. And yeah, it took me a long time to realize that, you know, a book about the space of childhood and toys, you know, could be a serious topic is something I gave myself permission to do, because it was just so fascinating, and I was, you know, kind of frustrated with other things written about, you know, toys, playgrounds, all of these children's spaces, and then I see that reflected in the history when they talk about, okay, so, you know, toys were something that it was okay for women to design. Much as, you know, the women in the Bauhaus were in the weaving studio. And so that there's this long history of women who were like only allowed to design toys, like only allowed to talk about the toys. And so it's really this whole, I feel like it's this whole kind of teeming universe that's like waiting to get out.
And if I can sort of jump in from the Lego perspective on that very issue, we also chatted a bit about this earlier, but the company has a very sort of troublesome relationship with the idea of gender, as we've seen in the sort of recent idea with the Friends sets and pink Lego and is that good, is that bad? Was the sort of gender-neutral golden age of the company truly gender-neutral? One of the things that I would love to continue teasing out a little bit is in the sort of the company's internal photographs from the model shops, you know, the model building shops for making these large, really complex constructions for Legoland, for the theme parks, for promotional purposes. Almost all of the builders in these shops are women. And they're, you know, they're doing these incredibly beautiful complex constructions, but they're completely outside of the company's sort of public image. So that's, I don't know if that, you know, in that way, it's sort of this, they're able to be behind the scenes working on the sort of public material things that represent the company, but they're not represented in other media. So it's something that I'm particularly interested in.
But I think that the whole issue of gender is part of the sort of politicization of the sexes that has happened in the past 120 years or so. And it's not just in toys. I mean, there's a tremendous amount of work in my field on the British interior in which, you know, the gender-specific rooms are discussed. Rooms for women, you know, particularly in a structured society such as the upper classes and the middle classes in Great Britain. And I think it's just in all of our minds, and any historian today can't escape it.
Can't escape it. I have a chapter of my dissertation all about the impact of feminism on children's toys, and I look at some activists not unlike the Shindana crowd of a different class, mostly white upper middle class women living in New York, some of whom are still active in early childhood feminist progressive education, who began building their own toys, first actually making prototypes out of wood, which is interesting, but then when they had them produced by some big companies like Milton Bradley for a short time in the 70s, they had to settle for plastic, or sometimes they were paper doll style toys. So yeah, that's another side of the story.
If I could just add, I didn't really, you know, tease this out specifically earlier, but certainly the Vienna Invention of Toys were, you know, venerating gender-neutral play, and specifically rejected would be the idea of something like a kitchen or a technical miniature, you know, so socializing boys and girls into the idea of being an engineer or, you know, through construction play or housewifery. And of course, gender, it's already been said, is central to why certain classes of material objects are viewed as more worthy or less worthy of study, and, you know, the idea of women's natural connection to handcraft. In my case, in my larger project, I find it interesting how in the interwar period, many women artists connected to the Vienna Invention were able to market their childlike, their supposedly natural connection to children, to position themselves as domestic primitives in a way, and marketing this childlike design language as a way of exploring expressionist ideas, but through handcraft.
Just to finish out for the sake of consistency, I sort of...
Yeah, thank you all. I'm like, wow, this is exactly what I wanted.
I sort of stumbled into the gendered aspect of it because, as I suspect it's not a unique experience, I struggled to find a topic for my dissertation that seemed interesting to me and enough to work on, and I wound up with dolls, houses, and miniatures in general, and I needed to focus in besides that, so I started looking at specific objects to analyze, and just found this particular category fascinating, and I don't know exactly why I found the little kitchens fascinating, but then I needed to find a rationalization for discussing them at length. And from my material culture background that emphasizes look at the thing, not just what all the intellectuals have pontificated about the thing, but actually examine the material object itself. And looking at them struck me that this can't really function as a how-to-do-it didactic toy in the way it's just sort of summarized. So I suppose to a certain extent it's accidental that I was dealing with a gendered aspect to it.
Ivan.
Thanks very much for all these papers. I've enjoyed today enormously. I'd be curious, though, if anyone on the panel could describe for us, from any society, anywhere, at any time, a toy that's not a commodity.
Well, I think just, again, in the kind of contemporary setting, there is a new interest in DIY for children on this kind of organic mommy blog that I look at partially to irritate myself. I'm going to tell you. Last week they were on a beach vacation and she and her children found forked sticks and they all made stick weavings between the forks of the sticks. And I see this as a kind of movement actually somewhat connected to the revival of homeschooling, where people want their children to, make their own toys. We're not going to buy anything. We're going to, make it out of paper. We're going to make it out of sticks. We're going to paint rocks, etc. So I think while that in itself may soon be commodified, there is an attempt to move against the, particularly virulent marketing to children in that way.
And there are elements, obviously, like water, playgrounds especially. You love to have water there because it is that material that is ever present. And obviously, although in California it's plenty commodified.
Yes.
Yeah, it's a commodity, for sure. Yeah.
Boxes that the toys come in.
Yeah.
Think about it that way. It's we'll play with on the spot.
Create an environment. Yeah. I wonder if we could ask this question, how important is childhood for understanding toys? Can we separate toys and conversations about toys from childhood? And by childhood, I want to make it clear that we're not necessarily talking about real actors, children, but rather a concept.
Well, I would begin by saying that I think our current equation of toys with childhood is definitely a post-Rousseau phenomenon.
Sure.
That before the 18th century, the English word toy did not mean child's plaything. It meant a little trifling, amusing gimcrack available to anybody. Before the 18th century, there really wasn't such a thing as a toy maker. There were craftsmen who did little fun novelties in their downtime or with their leavings. And play was certainly something seen as appropriate to adults and children. There was activity going on by grown people that now we would think is childish, but was seen as perfectly normal then. So I think that we can talk about toys without talking about children. I don't know if we can talk about toys now without talking about children.
I think you can, in terms of the number of toys that are made for grown-ups. Mm-hmm. Play some, the shiny cars, which you don't know what to do with, is because they're really not made for children. The market is adults. I think it's a nostalgia market. And I think it escapes children totally.
you see a little of that rising up in the sort of adult fan of Lego community. Absolutely, there's this whole conversation between, you know, prominent adult builders, shall we say, and company executives who are interested in using these super fans of the company to inform the marketing, to inform the design of the products. And so it's become the sense where adults are making toys with other adults for other adults, mm-hmm. although they end up being sort of filtered through this childlike marketing that the company has sort of created as its image. So in a case like that, where it is trying to split its activities and be everything to everyone, if you sort of carefully coordinate what you're looking at, you can absolutely talk about these toys and these playthings in very adult terms.
Yeah.
And at some level, they're probably operating more as collectibles than as playthings, but there's an enormous market amongst comic book geeks, for lack of a better term, for action figures, and
sure.
But then with them, mint in the box is much better than actually playing with the thing, and so ostensibly they want a toy, but then they don't really play with it. So, and I was once one of these people. So,
I think just to add on briefly,
yeah, sure.
A really interesting thing to bring up, I was fascinated by it in your paper, is the notion of authenticity and
mm-hmm.
this recourse to an authentic childlike perspective, or an authentic, in this case, you know, black perspective, and the slippery slope between reclaiming those stereotypes and slipping into them. And I was struck by the parallels between the debate in Secessionist Vienna on how, you know, folk art was so popular and trendy, you know, among artists and designers, and how there was a debate on what was true folk art. And many, like Riegel, would have said, well, only what is produced in the house, you know, supporting the notion that only the toy the child produced would be that.
So maybe we don't need children at all.
I'll just make toys for ourselves.
Okay, yeah, please. Marie, go ahead.
Well, just with that question, I think what was so compelling to me was the story of the woman, of the girl in the Klimt painting, in part because it was a story of a child's experience of this space, of the space of the house and of the things in it. Just how do you guys feel about studying and integrating the experience of children? And well, how does one do that as part of your work and as part of this discussion of childhood and toys? I mean, it's come up a little bit in all of your pieces to some degree, but I often see it, you know, the study of these things reveals much more about adults
yeah.
in the end than it does about children.
Yeah, I mean, it's not to, certainly not to rule it out. I mean,
yeah.
it would be great if there are a wealth of sources actually
right.
documenting how the children receive these toys, but unfortunately, probably most of what we're doing is documenting ideas about childhood and the,
mm-hmm.
you know, the surrounding it. So it's difficult to get at the reality of that. We can have glimpses onto it.
Mm-hmm. And maybe that's in fact precisely why our conversations, scholarly conversations, are largely about that.
Mm-hmm.
I know in my own work, if I go further and you know, keep talking about contemporary toys, I'm going to try to get access to some of the toy makers, and I'm hoping to be able to sit in on some of the testing sessions, which I referred to how, you know, Monument Valley, like I found out about it through my child, and so then it was kind of astonishing to me when I talked to the designer, and he said, oh, we never tested it on children. And for example, like the Toca Boca designers say, you know, they have a room full of five-year-olds in Stockholm, and they'll give them like the paper version of the game and then the early iPad version. And I'm hoping that I can like sit in on some of those sessions and kind of see that at work and how, you know, how the designers interact with the children, and also kind of how children evaluate things, because obviously they don't have the same critical language, but I know from my own experience, children can be quite critical. So, so yeah, I guess I'm hoping to get a little bit at the toy testing, and also that's where I think reading not just, you know, design history and theory, but some of the educational theory and thinking about how these things operate on the brain is important. There's a lot of intuition, I think, at work for designers, and it's just interesting like how right or wrong they can be.
Some good sociology too that's
yeah,
been done around
yeah.
children and, you know, narrative. Yeah.
But it's a sort of unscientific approach we take, because just of what survives is hit or miss. And there may have been whole areas of playthings that just don't survive, that we're not able to study. So it's really glimpses into the past when you work on historic toys. And it's like I always say, working on a puzzle where giant pieces are missing. Mm-hmm. And until those pieces ever discover to come forward, you really don't know the whole view.
Yeah. Well, even with when Barbie was introduced right at the toy fair in New York, she was rejected by most of the people that came in from the stores to buy and said, little girls will never accept this. And then, of course, she wound up being the most popular toy. So you really, there was something going on in the culture that, speaking about Mattel, Ruth Handler sort of felt or knew. And once she got it out there, it caught on. But the toy, but people thinking about children at that time didn't think it would work at all. And they were sort of horrified at the sexuality that the doll, you know, promoted. And then was introduced, and then was promoted as a toy to teach girls grooming themselves. You know, that's how they, that was what the research said, that they should, you know, market it for combing her hair. And women in the 50s would like the, or actually by 1960, would appreciate the idea that a doll existed to teach their kids how to keep themselves well groomed. So you can't really predict, I mean, a lot of this.
Yeah, and there's a great phrase from Bryan Sutton Smith, who is, of course, the preeminent anthropologist of play, in his book, Toys as Culture, where he just lays it out very explicitly that we have so little evidence about the linkage between these material objects and achievement, or, you know, student outcomes in today's parlance. What we have great evidence of in a lot of cases is the belief of the link between these objects and the achievements, or the particular effects. So that you do have to do a little bit of sort of interpretive gymnastics, as it were, to sort of try to get at the heart of the play experience. Through these sort of layers of adult anxieties and prescriptive ideas. And
but the rise of, but I also think it's interesting, the rise of, in the last century generally, but let's say in the last 50 or 60 years since the post-war period, at least in the United States, of children being the prime, increasingly the prime purchasers of toys, that they're actually buying them at the toy store. And maybe even if a parent is going with them, the parent is basically handing over the cash and the child goes to the register and picks out the toy and then goes to the register and pays for it. You at least get a sense in the last half century that the toys being purchased are more likely the ones that the children want, whereas previously, you don't really know, and we don't have the sources to find out if the children really enjoyed the toy. We just know that it sold out of this catalog in 1920, but we might not know, if we know it was the parents who bought it, we don't know if the children enjoyed it. Now we know the children love Barbie. I mean, the initial attempt to find out if Barbie would sell was a study that Carson Roberts, the ad agency, for Mattel carried out in 59. And they basically found that no mother, or very few mothers, they interviewed a couple hundred mothers with their children, no mother was interested in Barbie. They thought it was set. I mean, it's very interesting because it suggests a real preview of, you know, what will later be called the women's movement, but this is already 1959. These are mostly white middle-class mothers who are being interviewed in this research study. And they think it's sexist, they think it's objectifying, and they're not all using that language, but they're not interested. And then the children, they love it. So what does Mattel do? They sell it, right? And they sell millions. So it's, you know, it's 9 out of 10 children have 3 or more Barbies or something like that by the 1970s in the United States. So we learn that way from what children buy. And we might want to deny their desires and their pleasures, but the more we become a child-centered society post-Rousseau, the more we actually are facing what our children really want, which may or may not be wood. It may be those. I wrote Zoob on my hand because I'm going to go out and get those for my daughter.
Like kids, 80 seconds.
I'll go on my own. Those sound fantastic, but you know, if children are going to play with that, they'll play with that. And if they like the guns, they like the guns. But
yeah.
We learn more because of that opening of society to children's power in a way.
Mm-hmm. To get you.
I mean, just like in sort of direct response to that, though, I mean, are we learning more about what kids actually want, or are we learning more how successful we are advertising to kids? I mean, I love Barbie like I love a Big Mac. You know, it's advertised to me. Like,
day.
I can desire the Big Mac when I see it on
right.
the commercial. You know?
Right. But if we know the research studies say that the children want Barbie and they're going by the research studies, which they are claiming they're all doing, and you can read Juliet Shore and others to find out, they really are studying children. They're not joking around.
Right.
They are studying what children want, and they're saying, this is what children want, and if we're all about giving children what they want...
Are they studying what the child wants, or what their friends have influenced that?
And that's part of it,
that
too.
Is that other aspect of
yeah.
it? If he has, she has it. And it's really special, why
right.
can't I have it?
So there's a great book on that by Allison
Pugh,
a sociologist, called Longing and Belonging, if anybody's interested. It's pretty amazing just about how toys are purchased by parents and why they're purchased. And it's very interesting.
And the ways that they function as a kind of economy of the playground.
Yeah,
right.
Yeah.
Okay, Alexandra, then
sorry,
Liza.
Just one thing to that question. I think there's actually been a shift in the amount to which children are being directly marketed to with the advent of on-demand television. Because, you know, for many years when kids were watching television, they were seeing a million of those ads that many of us can still sing all the jingles to. But now that more kids are watching TV via Netflix and other services like that, they're actually seeing less of that kind of advertising. They may also be seeing less newspaper advertising because people aren't getting newspapers with Sunday supplements anymore that had a tremendous amount of toy ads. So I actually think over like the last 5 to 10 years, there's been a shift that I'm sure somebody will be studying about like the different ways that children are finding out about things, because it's definitely a different system than it was 10 years ago.
Do you think that means parents are buying more kids for children that the children actually don't want?
No, I mean, I do think there's a lot of peer-to-peer influence and seeing things at friends' houses.
Right.
And then, well, just in my own experience, my son started making his own Amazon wish list, and so now he actually like knows both how much all the toys cost and knows how to search for like all the things in a set. Like, it's like the whole universe of toys is open to him, but he knows how much they cost, and I've told him how much I think somebody will spend, say, for a birthday present. So he's already understanding the toy economy. Actually, sorry, maybe this is off topic, but the other day he told me, Mom, this is how toys work. When they first come out, they're really expensive. Because this is all about the Star Wars Legos. When they first come out, they're really expensive. Then the price goes down. Then they become antiques. And then they become expensive again.
Right on.
I just wanted to make a comment that Susan made that piqued my interest, because the idea of what toys we don't know in history. I'm going back a little bit now, not the present, but going backwards again. And thinking about, I wrote an article a while ago about miniatures down under, toys that have, things have been discovered and excavated. Mm. And for instance, in the Thames, things that were discovered, toys from the, some of the Nuremberg fairs and things that ended up in the Thames, etc., metal things as well. But it was a haunting thought that you just gave in mentioning what don't we know from history? What did go in the waste bin of history, and in terms of toys? And that's quite a haunting thought of what we don't know, because it got thrown away for centuries, for many centuries. Children's toys got thrown away. I mean, you think also about, you know, like Toy Story, also taking it more to the present. And my children loved the last movie, they're older now, about the toys being given away and thrown away. And but it's just taking it to what you said, maybe you want to speak a little more about that.
Well, I think it's just on, as I said, toys. It's right. When you work as an art historian or a cultural historian, you know, you have all the pieces that are available at that time. And I mean, one of the frustrations of doing a show here is I did a William Kent show last year. I worked on it for 8 years, and you know, 2 weeks after it's up, I get these letters about people who have Kent in their houses, and you know, everything's been to print, and we're already out of date. I mean, there'll be a whole generation of new scholars who are going to say that everything that I wrote is off the mark, because you know, these archives come up that no one knows about, and you begin to look, you learn about something else in a field, and it begins to resonate, and you begin to realize, well, you've misinterpreted something. So being a sort of treasure hunter, which is what we all do here, is a very humbling experience, because you're up to date for a day.
To give a more humble example of that, when I was preparing my paper for today, I was working with a text that I basically wrote 12 years ago, and I had to make sure over the summer that I hasn't been a whole lot of stuff to come to light that would make me look a fool if I didn't revise my paper. So, and an interesting phenomenon that's occurred in just the short time since I had my dissertation accepted was the emergence of things like Tumblr and Flickr and Pinterest and all of that, and what, you know, things that we used to think that's the one and only there is, and turns out they're all over the place, and everybody's taking snapshots of them and putting them online now, and just the amount of data is exploding. And particularly if somebody wants to sell you something, they'll take lots and lots of really good pictures of it. So it's, yeah, it just, stuff just comes out all the time that you didn't know about before, and there's things that you have to rethink now.
Even in a much more recent sort of milieu, as with Lego and these, you know, 20th century toys, the company has a very vested interest in keeping much of that sort of historical stuff in its own archives, you know. And you alluded to some of the difficulties of working with said archives. I have the same experience. But that's where this sort of enormous community of collectors and sort of fans and really devoted people who aren't trained as historians but who have these things and the power of the internet to let them upload, you know, countless images of bits of cardboard packaging from 1950s for Lego. And that's such an amazing resource. These sort of kind of amateur historians, in a way, are huge partners, yes. I think, to the sort of academic enterprise in that case.
Particularly for things that high-toned academe has not thought was important enough to pay attention to.
Okay, actually, I think we were at 4:30, and I would encourage conversation to continue over a glass of wine. I want to thank all of our speakers for today. They have all received their degrees and PhDs after in the 21st century, so this is really the future of the kind of work that is going to continue on. And I think Susan and I are both really delighted that you were all here to participate with us in this really lively and interesting conversation. So thank you very much.